ಒಂದು ಗುರುವಿನ ಉಪದೇಶದ ಮುಖಾಂತರ ಸಾಧನೆಯನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದಾಗ ಮಾತ್ರ ನನಗೆ ಆ ಪರಮ ಗುರುವಿನ
ಹಲೋ
ಭರತ್ ಯು ಟು ಅನ್ಮ್ಯೂಟ್ ಯುವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್
Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV Online One Talk, One Speaker series. And to introduce today's speaker and the topic and the panelist, I hand over to our moderator, Dr. B. Shivshankar, President-elect, Indian Orthopedic Association. You're muted, sir.
Oh, yeah. Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Neeraj, for this wonderful platform to have different speaker to talk on various subjects. Friends, today we'll have a talk on distal radial fractures from the time of Abraham Colles, who discovered or who told about this Colles fracture even before, when we were not having the X-rays. As we all know, Roentgen invented X-ray machine much later, but Abraham Colles has described this deformity long time back, and Dr. Anil Bhatt is the assistant dean at KMC Manipal, one of the most important or well known world over institution in the world, the KMC group of institution. So he is the assistant dean there. He'll be talking about distal radial fracture from the time of Colles to corona. To introduce Dr. Anil Bhatt, he has done his MBBS from Bangalore Medical College and MS from KMC Manipal. He has also subsequently passed the National Board Examination, DNB. He is at present working as the dean in KMC Manipal Hospital. He's also working as professor and unit head of hand and microsurgery unit. He in the past has worked as the head of the Department of Orthopedic Surgery in the same institution. He has special interest in hand surgery, wrist disorders, including wrist arthroscopy, congenital hand differences, tendon reconstruction, elbow disorders, and sports injuries of the upper limb, endoscopic carpal tunnel release, 3D printing of the hand prosthesis and orthosis, etc. Hand surgery, he has done hand surgery fellowships in UK, Singapore, and Hong Kong. He is the chief coordinator HASTA, or the Center for Congenital Hand Deformities at Manipal Academy of Higher Education. He is the coordinator of the 3D printing in the Center of Hand Prosthesis for Children at Artificial Limb Center, Kasturba Medical College, Manipal. He is the chief editor, Journal of Karnataka Orthopedic Association. He is a PhD guide registered at Manipal University. He has, to his credit, 78 international and national publications, 26 academic awards, 6 PhD theses have been done under him. He has done also 5 funded projects of various projects. He has 6 fellows working under him in the hand department, and he has given 116 scientific presentations, and he has authored a very useful book, and he has co-authored 2 textbooks. The one book he has authored is How to Examine Patient, that is mainly for a PG student. That's a very big book. Along with Dr. Anil Bhatt, we have an expert panel of panelists in the form of Dr. Amit Ajgaonkar from Mumbai, Dr. Bharat Kadadi from Bangalore, and Dr. Asim Negi from Indore. We also have Dr. Neeraj Bijlani and Ashok Shyam from Ortho TV to coordinate. Dr. Bharat Kadadi is a hand surgeon from Bengaluru. He has done his MBBS from Mysore Medical College and then MS from JJM Medical College, Davanagere. He has subsequently done hand fellowship in Stanley Medical College, Chennai, brachial plexus fellowship in 2008 at Japan. Presently, he is working as director of Bangalore Hand Surgery, which is located in Rajajinagar, Bangalore. He has conducted many state and national level workshops on hand, wrist, and brachial plexus. He has also publication in many national and international reputed index journals, mainly about birth injuries of the brachial plexus. He is a very passionate teacher and a very skilled surgeon. Special interest in surgery of brachial plexus, birth palsy, and wrist arthroscopy. The other panelist we have is Dr. Asim Negi from Indore. He has done his MS orthopedic from MGM Medical College, Indore. Then subsequently he has also done MCH and worked for 11 years in BYL Nair Hospital, Mumbai as consultant in various posts. He has specialized in orthopedic treatment of complex trauma and joint replacement. He has a special interest in spine surgeries. He is also working at present at Gokuldas Hospital in Indore, which is a high working center for orthopedic. We have Dr. Amit Ajgaonkar from Mumbai. Amit doesn't need any introduction because he is known as the trauma man of India, and he was the TraumaCon main person who conducts every year this TraumaCon. Of course, next week on 15th and 16th, it will be done virtually this year also. He has done his MS orthopedics and DRTO and FCPS orthopedics from Mumbai. And he specializes in orthopedic treatment of trauma, joint replacement. And he is a visiting doctor at Bhagavati Hospital, Borivali. He is owner and CEO of Zenith Hospital, one of the large hospitals in the suburbs of Mumbai. His achievements, he has done more than 1,500 complex trauma and joint replacement surgeries in his new hospital already. He has got Excellency Award in the field of trauma from National Association of Interlocking Surgeons, that is NAILS, Best Faculty Award from the TraumaCon, and he is the past secretary of Bombay Orthopedic Society, Trauma Society of India, National Association of Interlocking Surgeons, and he is the present president of NAILS. Dr. Amit Ajgaonkar, I keep meeting him for the last 20 years, at least 20 times in a year. You can see these are some of the various times I have met him. This is during the TraumaCon. He is one of the main person organizing, though he is standing behind, but with other TraumaCon people, he is there. Then this is in Aurangabad during MOACon. Recently at IOACon Delhi, Kolkata, he was there. I enjoy traveling with him because he is a foodie. He likes to eat food. And here you can see in Kodaikanal when we were there along with Dr. Tanna. 2 years back, we were in Patna and we visited the Patna Sahib. That time when we came out early in the morning, it was about 5 or 5:30 in the morning. He sat himself and prepared coffee, tea for all of us in one of the roadside joints. So really, the time we spend with him is so beautiful and it's always enjoyable. Recently, just before the lockdown, all of us were there again for a Telangana State Conference at Nizamabad. You can see him here again enjoying with a mug of water early in the morning, the breakfast in one of the roadside hotels. This is in 2012 at Coimbatore. Then I have conducted not less than about 50 workshops with him all over India. This is in Ujjain when we went for the workshop. We also went to Omkareshwar and Mamaleshwar, those places we went. Then even Pondicherry, we have conducted workshops. So many things. I have so many things to talk about him. And these pictures I'm intentionally showing that he keeps asking me, Shiva, you take so many pictures, what you are going to do? So Amit, for this purpose, I have taken all the pictures.
Thank you for that.
So, yeah, I'll be moderating this session. If anyone has a doubt, please ask your question on my WhatsApp, the mobile number you can see. Or if you have a case to be shown, you can also share. Not only for this webinar, even for subsequent webinars, you can share your presentation on my Gmail. I welcome Dr. Anil Bhatt to start his presentation on distal radial fractures. Welcome, Dr. Anil Bhatt. You are muted.
Thank you very much. I'll be sharing the screen. Is it seen?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Shiv Shankar, for this wonderful opportunity which you have given. I met him in last year in Pondicherry, and we were talking a lot of things, especially about medical education itself. And I'll come to that later. But in this topic is very close to my heart, the distal radius fracture itself. And he asked me, give me a very catchy title. And I said, I think the catchy title is one thing, but Corona is catching everybody. So we'll call this as From the Times of Police to Corona. And that's how the title came up here. I don't have any conflict of interest or disclosures. I acknowledge my the assistance of my unit, faculty and residents for sourcing the information for this talk, Dr. Ashwar, Saurabh, Siddharth, Abhijit. If you look at this man, he's been there with me since my PG days, because I was asked to prepare a seminar in my postgraduate, I think first year. And then they said, my professor said, get the original write-up of Abraham Kolis. And I did get it from the library those days. It was quite difficult to get these original texts. We had to write to Delhi from the National Medical Library, and I got this somehow. And then for the pain I went through to get this, I was really, not very happy reading all these things. But then when I read this recently, the entire description of Kolis fracture, the way he's written, and the way, how beautifully it is written, the most clear description of the fracture itself, purely based on clinical examination, it really amazes how somebody could do this kind of work. And we are so much lacking in our documentation nowadays. And this is one masterpiece in that sense. Life is basically a cycle. And then if you look at this, it's basically the knowledge which will direct our understanding. So what Kolis gave was knowledge about that particular fracture, that particular injury, and made us understand what is happening there, which again further affects the future knowledge. And subsequently, there were other surgeons who came in, and then they increased the knowledge of this particular injury itself. So this is what happens, and life is always a cycle. And as I said, his description was purely based on clinical observations alone, and X-rays were discovered almost 80, 81 years later. His statement is always been criticized. At some remote period, again, enjoys perfect freedom in all its motion and be completely exempt from pain. It's always been criticized. It's always been told, no, it's not correct. When I was reading a lot of literature for this talk, I realized probably he has actually told some truth, and probably we need to realize that. And the time may have come to revisit this statement in reality. The scope of this talk is basically to understand the principles in decision-making, to trace the treatment evolution itself, and to learn from a mistakes which is cushioned by evidence. Now we have a lot of evidence, and definitely not to forget the basic skills in spite of all the latest implants and gadgets. And this pandemic is the proof that we have to go back to those basic skills, the basic kinds of treatment. We are forced to do it actually, in spite of having the best of the implants right now. Now, principles in decision-making basically relies for a distal radius, especially after patient characteristics, it's basically the imaging. So you have a patient who walks into the OPD or a trauma triage, and you know there's a distal radius fracture. Obviously, the first thing you would ask is an X-ray or a CT. The second principle for decision-making is we need to understand what is a stable fracture and what is an unstable fracture. And third, probably to a little extent, the treatment guided by classification. Now, as I said, apart from clinical examination, whenever my resident calls me and tells that there is a distal radius fracture and they've taken an X-ray, I always ask them to have a checklist with them. So if you see this, it should run in your mind what exactly is happening in that X-ray. What is the bone stock of this patient? Is it an extra or an intra-articular fracture? If it's an intra-articular fracture, what are the intra-articular components? The height and inclination. You don't really need to draw all these lines, but you need to run through your mind exactly all these parameters. What has happened to the articular surface? You all have packs nowadays, and you can zoom it and see all these very beautifully, unlike those old X-ray films. Always stick to the basic principles of one joint above and one joint below. In this case, it is the radiocarpal joint, the scaphoid, the scapholunate areas. And the one joint below, I call it here, would be the distal radioulnar joint. So this is the checklist you need to run every time you see an X-ray. And I said, you actually really don't have to draw these lines, but in your mind, you should know what's happening there. Is there a dorsal tilt? Is the palmar tilt is lost? And what's happened to all these things? The second thing is, a lot of times patient comes, an X-ray is taken, And then again, immediately a CT is done, which is absolutely useless a lot of times. Doing a CT without a close reduction is basically trying to get the same kind of picture what the X-ray is showing. So a CT would be always much better once you do a close reduction, whatever possible, whatever the patient allows you to do with some amount of analgesia. And then the CT gives you an exact picture of where these fragments are, and that helps you in your decision making. So just doing an X-ray and a CT immediately back to back absolutely would give you no major information. The third is not to assume all fracture are stable or might remain stable, which means to say that we need to know exactly when you look at an X-ray, what is stable and what is not. If that X-ray shows that there is a comminution, especially on the dorsal aspect here, which is more than 50%, if the angulation is more than 20 degrees of tilt, the shortening is more than a centimeter, the fracture pattern is there, especially shearing or Barton's kind of fracture or a carpal dislocation, an ulnar styloid base fracture, especially with clinically evident distal radial joint instability, or a bone stock which has got severe osteoporosis. These are all unstable situations, which basically means, again, we should not be compromising on our treatment when we know that the fracture inherently is unstable, or after reduction, it might not remain stable. So which again comes to the point that not to hold on to the unstable fracture with unstable means. For unstable fractures, probably it could be a plaster or a KYS in some situations, which is an unstable means. But otherwise, if a fracture is unstable and the patient is not willing for surgery for what you want to do, please document that and counsel the patient for complications. Very, very important nowadays, because there might be residual malunion, there might be residual DRG instability. So these are the things you need to anticipate. More so in the situation now where we are trying to do most of these as non-operative management. So in a pandemic situation, again, we're following the same principle that you need to document, because these patients, there will be a cohort of patients who will now come back after some months with complications, expected complications, because we try to do non-operative management in this scenario. So this is very, very important for us. Now, there are numerous classifications. I won't go into the detail. Ideally, a classification should guide the treatment, and a combination of many of these gives a comprehensive guideline. I still love the Frickman's classification, even though it was a very old classification. Probably it was the first time somebody drew our attention to the radiocarpal joint, the distal radial ulnar joint, the ulnar styloid, what's happening there. Until then, nobody talked about all these things. And even now, it's very, very relevant for us. The Medoff's classification told us what are these fragments. It's a spin-off from the Malone's classification and tells us exactly where these fragments are, especially in intra-articular situation. The Regazzoni's thing is more of a columnar concept. And we realize that intermediate column is a very, very important column there, which is taking the entire weight, and the distal radial ulnar joint is close by. So that needs to be restored always. And finally, the Fernandez classification, which is based on mechanism, which I like personally, because it tells you exactly what is to be done. But a smart surgeon would combine all these things. I won't go into the details of AVO and other classification, because it's more of a research purpose. In a practical day-to-day things, I need to look at the radiocarpal joint. I need to look at the ulnar styloid. I need to see what intra-articular components are there, especially this ulnar rim here. I need to see which column is involved, and I also want to know the mechanism. So combining all these would make sense for me to go ahead and treat a particular fracture. I would want to trace the evolution of the treatment and the evidence itself. Now, I would trace the same way as Dr. Shivshankar mentioned, but I also would like to trace how we look at distal radius now. We don't look distal radius in its isolation. It's a part of forearm joint. So there is a distal radial ulnar joint, then it's also a part of the radiocarpal joint, and there are things which can happen here. So I would like to trace how the treatment has developed from just putting a plate here to going all the way inside the joint here. Now, the treatment has progressed from reduction of a deformity to anatomical reduction to achieve the pre-injury function. That is a major change which has happened over the years. And we have a plethora of treatment options, right from close reduction, immobilization to percutaneous pinning, external fixators, plate fixation, and the newer modalities of arthroscopic assisted fixation, bridge plating concepts. All these have come. What you choose, it is your expertise and the need for the fracture and the patient. So all these have to be put together for you to choose this. We can always also divide this into three eras, basically one before the X-rays, where casting and splinting was the main option available, right from Egyptians, to Hippocrates. Hippocrates basically misdiagnosed this as a radiocarpal dislocation. And then Poitou fracture, what is called in France, actually, he was the one who described this in a very detailed way. But obviously, he didn't get the recognition what Collis got later on. And one of the major changes which happened during those time was immobilization changed from palmarflexion to dorsiflexion. Collis, in his treatise, very beautifully tells how exactly you need to reduce that dorsal displacement. But then there was another kind of immobilization which used to happen, which is called as a cotton loader position, which was an extreme of palmarflexion. And over the years, we realized that it is not physiological and there used to be extreme compression. Chanley was the person who told that that is not correct. And then later, recently as 1984, Gelbman proved that the carpal tunnel pressures in this position is really high. And so that's why the cotton loader position was abandoned long back. And tight cast syndrome, so many things used to happen with this. The next era is basically the X-ray of era and plasters. So from the era of glue, resins, and wax, by about 1850, the POP came into picture. And then the positions, or the splinting, the way it was splinted, the way traction was applied, the way the slings were maintained, all those got streamlined over the years. But the big paradigm shift came with Roentgen. Once the X-rays were discovered by him, and the first X-ray was taken in December 1895, and within another couple of months, in February 1896, the first clinical application of X-ray in the US was to diagnose actually the Collis fracture. So the first clinical use of X-ray was actually for Collis fracture. But then we should not forget this man. I mean, it's humongous amount of contribution towards joint replacement. But then one of the most beautiful book written about close treatment of common fractures, and that's by Dr. John Chanley. And he's described it so beautifully in terms of the mechanical analogy in reducing a Collis fracture, how to reduce and apply the cast, what is this anvil hand and what is the reducing hand, what type of grip you need to put. This called as the Robert Jones grip, which is applied here, how to give the traction, how the anvil hand remains stationary, and how the reducing hand uses and makes the manipulation. Why the thumb and the fifth finger is excluded in a plaster? The science behind this is beautifully explained in this book. And again, the three-point fixation, again, is beautifully explained in this book. So these are the things I think now is the time, again, to go back and read this, because we have been doing this more often now in our practice. The bigger evidence came as recently as 2018 with the British Society of Hand Surgery, the Blue Book, the best practice for management of distalradius fractures. It's got the best of the meta-analysis and RCTs, which has been shown. Now, if you talk of conservative or operative management, there is no clear-cut evidence for any type of treatment option for the population between 50 and 65 years of age. For patients over 65, there's definitely a proof that operative intervention does not provide a superior outcome to non-operative management, especially in low demand patients, which is a very high demand patient, yes, but otherwise majority of them actually need not be doing that great with an operative intervention. So these are the proof for that. This is a systematic review and meta-analysis, which said that the clinical outcomes are similar for both treatment options when you compare in the elderly patients, the conservative versus operative management. There's another randomized multicenter study, which again says the evidence is marginal and inconsistent, and primarily non-surgical management is also affecting suitable patients. There's another prospective randomized trial, especially in patients above 65, elderly patients, again says that the achieving anatomical reconstruction did not convey any improvement in terms of range of motion or the ability to perform daily activities in these cohorts. So, but then close reduction is not a simple thing. Remember that close reduction has more work than going and operating. Close reduction requires close monitoring and follow-up of these patients. So if you put a patient in a cast and send them for a close reduction kind of a treatment, they need to be followed up nicely, especially the first 3 weeks. This is where the displacements are happening, the edema is settling down, the cast is becoming loose. So at least the first 3 weeks is where you have to take a decision whether you want to go towards an operative management or continue the cast. Patient again should be warned. So this is the third week X-ray. There is some amount of settling happening here. There's some amount of displacement happening here. And this is the crucial time where you need to talk to the patient. Will you accept this? There will be some malunion. There might be some restriction of movement. Or would you go back and can we operate on this? So that is a shared decision between you and the patient. This is a 6 weeks follow-up. This is a 6 month follow-up. You've seen that. You see that there is a malunion here. But then this patient clinically is absolutely fine, doing good. They got good range of motion, occasional pain, but otherwise patient is very happy. So this is a very important shared decision you need to take with this patient for these kind of treatment. When you come to operative treatment, the timing of surgery for distal radius fractures given by the NICE guidelines from the NHS says within 72 hours for intra-articular fractures and within 7 days for extra-articular fractures. Now, the previous scenario which I showed, where there is a redisplacement of distal radius fractures and you have to decide to perform surgery within 72 hours after you decide that you operate. So that is the best way to deal with these patients. Coming to the implants itself, the KYS, the operative treatment itself came in only after Lister established the antisepsis concepts. Until then, people were scared to do any kind of surgeries. Lambert use of K-wire and radial styler, and then DPAMA, where it's more of a allo radial kind of pinning. These are the things, techniques which came in initially with the K-wires. Of course, there are many, many techniques with K-wires, but these were the initial ones. And then till like 1970s, where we have the Kapanji's intrafocal kind of a pinning. So there are various techniques involved in this. But then you need to again know if we're using the K-wires for what indication, what type of mechanism, a bending kind of fracture or an avulsion kind of fracture. It's also important to know how you put these K-wires. A cross pinning like this is the most important way of putting it to avoid rotation. The K-wise crossing proximal to the distal, the radial fracture is again an important thing, and not crossing at the fracture site. That's a very important concept. And then again, you need to look at the ulnar styloid, see what's happened to it, whether the DRVG is unstable or not. In a lateral view, again, you need to see that these are spread out nicely. These K-wise, they should not become parallel there, then the rotational forces increases. So again, this kind of a construct, if you use these K-wires, will definitely work well for this patient. Again, if you look at the evidence now, K-wiring versus open reduction internal fixation, this is the meta-analysis done, shows that volar locking plates are better, but then the differences are not really clinically important. That's what is the author's conclusion. Another, the famous draft trial from the UK, they said absolutely there's no difference between K-wires and volar locking plates. But if you really analyze this study, there are a lot of flaws in the study as to why they came to this conclusion. So you can't really equate a K-wire with a volar locking plate and say that there's no difference. This is another meta-analysis where there was inconclusive or insufficient data, but they did say that there is lower DASH scores and reduced post-op complications for a volar locking plate. So these are the evidence for K-wire versus open reduction. In between this, people did use both the cast and the K-wires, the classic pin and plaster technique, which a lot of people used to use in between these. Now, if you trace the history of external fixator itself, early 20th century, that's when the principles of ligamentous taxis came. And Murray's, this kind of adhesive traction was probably the first of these to use these principles of ligamentous taxis. And then you have Bowler who came in to give combination of pins and plaster again for the same principle. And then the concept of non-bridging and bridging fixators came. Now the bridging fixators, basically because fixators were being used rampantly for everything, even for intra-articular fractures. And so there used to be invariably the metaphyseal collapse once the fixator was removed and shortening. So to overcome that, they had to span the joint, go towards the metacarpal, but still this really didn't help much. This is the Anderson and O'Neill kind of a bridging kind of external fixators. I think 1980s, 90s were the external fixators are the mainstay of treatment, but still they couldn't be really used for a volar bottom kind of a shear fracture, lunate fossa depressions or articular combinations. If somebody used it, probably they had complications. It's like this. Right? If you have this kind of a fracture here where there is a depression here, you need to really distract this so much here to get some decent reduction. And what you're basically doing is you're stretching all these soft tissues so badly that it's a recipe for disaster. CRP, stiffness, so many other problems happen when you stretch them and distract them so much. So this is not a good indication for that. Then another thing is, again, for you to know whether your external fixator works or not, a simple way is to do a traction view. in the OT, when you before you start your procedure, if you can do a traction view like this, you know what fragments are falling back or what is not, what is being pulled up. And that is when you can make your plans, whether you go ahead with external fixation or you need to do something else. Not much of evidence between external fixation and ORIF. This is one long-term meta-analysis, which shows that there is no difference in outcomes with either form of treatment. Even though flexion extension arc was better in ORIF group, it was not clinically meaningful. This is another comparison again of internal and external fixation, a meta-analysis of the randomized trials. They said that the patient who received internal fixation using ulnar locking plates for the treatment of distal radius recovered more quickly than the patients with external fixator. Again, no hard evidence as such between external fixator and ORIF. Now again, best of both can be used like your pin and plaster technique. Here again, KOIS and external fixator can be used where you can do a limited open reduction to elevate these depressed fragments, or even percutaneously using a joystick, you can use this and use the both of these kind of methods. So the evidence so far, what I have told you, non-operative treatment recommended strongly for patients above 65 years of age with low demand. KOIS still have a large role to play. External fixators probably in a very few selected cases, and then plates with their design versatility can help in many patterns of fracture fixation. And so I think the world has moved towards more and more towards the plate itself. If you come to the plates, again, till 1960, absolutely no reports. Some case reports came in about 1960, very minimal use almost till 1990s. The first generation plates were actually dorsal plates. This dorsal pie plates and the dorsal fort plate, these are the ones which came in there, but they were a very large profile plates, quite thick, causing tendon irritation, rupture, and the need to shave off the Lister's tubercle. So they usually caused a lot of problems and they fell out of favor very soon. The first generation ulnar locking plates, I'm sure all of us have used these Ellis plates and buttress plates which came in. The second generation is the locking plates, and the third generation, of course, is the polyaxial or the variable angle kind of thing. Now, off late, we know that there is areas where these ulnar plates won't reach, the dorsal combination, the dorsal lunate fossa. These are the ones which require fragment-specific kind of fixation and almost a sandwich kind of a plating. And these have become very low profile now, and they can be used very nicely. And you don't really have to take off these Lister's tubercle for these kind of plates. What are the indications, type of plate, exposure? I'll just come to all these quickly. So ulnar and dorsal, probably this dorsal lunate area is one area where your ulnar plates might not really be effective. And this is one, probably for me personally, this is an absolute indication to put a dorsal plate. Otherwise, most of us would use ulnar plate. Majority of our fixations are because if you see this beautiful surface here of the distal radius, the plate is it's made for a plate actually. So this is the one which we most of us use, but otherwise, you should also know the indications when you have to use the dorsal plate. Now, you have extra-articular kind of plates, you have juxta-articular kind of plates, you have rim plates, and you also have fragment-specific plates. So there are various designs. It's up to you where you have to use it and how you have to use it. And they can be fixed angle or they can be variable angle kind of plates. The indications basically is in shear fracture. Classically, if you look at the Fernandez classification, the plate is made for a shear kind of where you have to buttress the shear fragment. And sometimes the die punch kind of a thing, a compression thing. And sometimes if it's a very complex fracture, you need a hybrid kind of fix. You need plate, you need X-fix, you might need KOIS. The bending and avulsion types of fractures can be managed with other methods. Exposure, you need to be flexible. If you have this modified Henry's approach, you can turn wherever you want, actually the distal part, wherever your major fragments are. You can go dorsally, radially like this. You can go towards the ulna side, you can keep it straight. It all depends on where your fragments are. Or if you want to straight away hit the lunate facet fracture here, you can go with an extended FCR approach and release the carpal tunnel and directly go to this medial fragment here near the sigmoid notch. So you need to be flexible with this. The second is you should know the concept of watershed line itself. The watershed line basically means that where the pronator quadratus is ending here, okay, and where the capsule is starting, and there is a junction, there's a transition zone between this of fibrous tissue where this tendon is attached and the capsule here is starting off. So this is the point where most of your plate, the regular plate starts, and that is your watershed line. Why is it important? Now, if you have your regular plate, if you have your regular ulna plate, as I said, that surface is actually made for this kind of plates. So it sits very nicely here in this hollow of the pronator quadratus. As you start moving distally, as you cross this watershed line, then you notice that if it is not of a low profile, this is standing proud there. And the most important structure here is the FPL. And the tendon irritations happen, and the FPL is the one which is the victim most of the times. So when you expose your distal radius fixations, always expose it nicely and go all the way till there so that your plate position becomes quite nice and easy. A lot of times I see that the exposure is not adequate enough and you don't really go all the way distally there, and you really don't see this. The second part is, once you've done it, your exposure of pronator quadratus is very, very important. As much as possible, do a very nice soft tissue dissection. A lot of times the pronator quadratus is lacerated in a very high energy trauma. A lot of times some individuals have very thin pronator quadratus. The thickness of these pronator quadratus muscle varies. But as far as possible, if you can lift this off very nicely, you can actually repair it back nicely. So this dissection, you need to take some time. And I know a lot of surgeons who directly go to the bone through and through. But for me, this is a very good cover for my plate later on. You also need to keep a rim of this muscle here along with this periosteum so that it's easy for you to suture it on this aspect here. So it's a very important step in your dissection of your distal radius. The second thing is this radial translation. It's always been told that the prognosis is poor in patients with having very bad radial translation because it directly affects the distal radial joint here. And the deforming force is basically the brachioradial is here. So when you have this kind of a thing, your reduction is not coming in. You need to go all the way till there to release the brachioradialis. Almost you will see the first dorsal compartment here of the extensor side, but you need to release this brachioradialis and get this fragment back and reduce it nicely. That's a very, very important step. Once you put in your plate, and then the most important thing is make sure that you check your screw position, which basically means any projecting screws need to be checked. Now, if you look at, you have a normal palmar tilt, right? If you want to neutralize that, you need to elevate the hand by about 10 degrees or 20 degrees, depending on the amount of tilt. And that is where you see this profile very beautifully. So this is what you need to do once you fix these and then put the screws. So if you have something like this and you feel that these screws are inside the joint here, right? That 20 degree tilt here will give you, or 10 degree tilt will give you that answer whether your screws have actually gone into the joint or not. Same with the PA view, because of the inclination, you might feel that some screws are there, but when you lift this up, you will see that this articular surface is not compromised. The radial styloid screw always feels that it's a very long screw because it's going towards radial styloid. A simple maneuver of screening the entire wrist just before you get out is very, very important for you to note that this is not in the joint. Actually, it's holding nicely in the radial styloid. So the oblique is very, very important for you to assess this. Now, the most important thing, again, is the dorsal proud screws, especially when you're using these ulna plates, locking plates. This is the culprit here. The Lister's tubercle is the culprit. It hides these proud screws here, and they can cause complications. And again, this line here, the dorsal subchondral plate line, anything going beyond this will cause irritation of the screws, I mean, the extensor tendons. So here, it's ideal to keep 2 to 4 millimeters short what you measure on the when you do your distal locking here, so that you don't really have to go get a bicortical purchase in most of these. And it also is safe for the extensor tendon. There are other views. This is called the dorsal tangential view. Again, the Lister's tubercle might be hiding this screw tip, and you might see this kind of a problems. And another one is a carpal shoot view like this, where you again see this edge of the articular surface here. And this particular screw here is long, and this probably needs to be revised. So these are things which you have to do once you fix it. The other most important thing is to check the distal radial ulna joint. Once you have fixed your distal radius fracture, especially if patient has ulna styloid fracture, and you need to assess clinically on table in all the positions, the pronation, supination, neutral positions, so that you know there are many secondary stabilizers here. You have an intraosseous membrane, the oblique bundle, pronator quadratus you have stripped off during your surgery. You have the ECU subsheath. We don't know what is injured. Is it the TFCC, or is it the ECU, or is it the intraosseous membrane? So any of these. So basically testing this and stabilizing this is very, very important. At least transfixing the DRUJ like this, especially in the ulnar styloid base fracture for about 3 weeks, or putting a cast for in a bovulbo position for about 3 weeks, allows these all these soft tissues to heal nicely, and then you can start mobilizing them. So very important for you to allow the soft tissues to heal. And once you've done all these, once your plate is placed, basically you have to suture the crater quadrata as much as possible. The phenomenon of creep comes into picture here. Right, a lot of people are telling me, sir, I can't really suture the crater quadratus back. How do you do it? So the simple way is basically the first knot is very important. So once you get this bite here, and then ask your assistant to relax this, and you get this. After this, wait for a couple of minutes, 2-3 minutes. You wait, and the creep phenomenon sets in, and the muscle becomes more relaxed, more stretched out here, and then it becomes very easy for you to suture the rest of the muscle. And if you have left a cuff of the normal muscle here along with the periosteum, you can most of the times very nicely cover the plate and suture it completely here. Why is it important? Because of this. This tendon FPL, if your plate was proud for whatever reason, if the screws are there, your plate is exposed, that FPL will get irritated and attrition can cause. So any of these tendons which are going there, crossing that area, are the ones which can go in two problems. So FPL attrition is one of the common things which we see. Now, I'm sure majority of you do your distal radius in and out daily. So I would not go into a regular kind of a case. And I think we have a lot of cases later to discuss. I'll discuss few difficult ones which we normally see routinely. One is the lunate facet fractures. Second is the rim fractures. And the third one is one distal radius fractures associated with carpal instability. These are scenarios where we always get patients referred to us with complications. And I'm just trying to highlight those things. This lunate facet fracture is the most underrated, underestimated fracture. And a lot of times we end up in trouble. So when you see a fracture like this, don't think that it's a very small, tiny fracture and we'll get away with it. No, it always causes a lot of problems. What is the implant? What is the approach? What are the technical difficulties? And what are the complications? These are things you need to answer when you see this patient. Now, if you see this, you know that it's a lunate facet fracture. You can have one more X-ray, like an oblique view, to see the exact nature of this. And obviously, you would ask for a CT. And as I said, reduce the fracture and then get the CT done. Do a close reduction. The CT would always tell you where this fracture wage, the major, the axial views would give you very beautifully where this is the entire sigmoid notch is split here halfway through. And this entire diameter is increased here. And two concepts come in, the teardrop angle here and the anterior-posterior distance. The teardrop angle is where you have the lunate facet jutting out. And that is what it forms an angle, average about 65 to 70 degrees of angle here. And the AP distance where the entire distal radius is burst open sometimes. That is what is the indication. Again, about 10 millimeters or a centimeter is the usual thing, or rather it goes up to 20. And a depressed teardrop angle means that there is a problem in that ulnar lunate. That is the concept I'm trying to make there. Now, when you have these patients, when you start operating on them, the most important thing is to try to engage that fragment as much as possible with whatever instruments you have. You can use a bone lever like this and try to get that back into this. And a lot of times they'll be depressed and you need to elevate this. You need to elevate this up all the way so that you get your articular surface back here like this. Enhance the fixation. What do you mean by enhancing the fixation is I would use this raft wires very commonly in my practice where I want to hold this, what you've elevated here, the same concept of your proximal tibia and other areas. So using the K-wise as raft wise is a very good technique before you put in your plate. And then you go in and put a plate there. For a lunate facet, again, the wires can be of different configuration, how you want it. I just want this fragment to be held with my lever here, with this K-wise here. And sometimes I transfix the DRUJ, but then everything is holding it till my plate comes in here. At least you need two screws here of this to go into this fragment. That is the ideal way of doing it. And rafting is a very useful tool here. You can have a dedicated screw only for this, like a lag kind of a fixation here. You can put this screw here, or at least two screws if it goes and holds this fragment nicely, then this fragment stays because there's a lot of stress in the middle column, this weight-bearing column here. It's a part of two joints. Remember that it's a radiocarpal joint and it is the sigmoid notch here, which is a DRUJ joint. So this segment, this fragment is a part of two joints here, and losing this is always a problem. That is a another dedicated screw only for that particular fragment. This is another case, but with a complication. Again, lunette facet here fixed. All the principles followed, two screws going in there. By about third month, when the patient comes, already this collapse has happened. So again, there are caveats to this, where with less than 15 millimeters of the lunette facet available and greater than 5 millimeters of initial lunette subsidence are at risk of failure, even if the ulna plate is properly placed. So that's what happens in these patients. So Orbital said that this ulnar rim fragment here is the Achilles heel of the distal radius fracture fixation. It's a very strong bone there. It's like a calcar in your fracture neck of femur. So it's a very strong bone. And if it goes off, then the whole carpus collapses here. So the learning points here, again, is to be flexible on our operative approach. Go to the extended carpal tunnel approach here. You will see the fragment straight ahead. Instead of going to the modified Henry's, you go all the way there. Okay. And if you have dedicated plates for this, use them. Like this here. This is almost mimicking like a lunette facet. And these are specific plates called the hook plates only for this. These are called the tines, which will go into the bone here. You pre-drill this and then put this inside, and it holds these fragments very nicely. So these are special plates. If they're available, dedicated plates available, it can be used specifically for this. Now, the other kind of fracture is, it's called as a rim fracture. It's a very high energy, explosive energy here. The entire rim of the distal radius is disrupted here. And if you look at these are the fragments. You have the ulnar fragments here, which are coming in here. You have the radial fragments here. You have the dorsal fragments here, the dorsal ulnar corner here. And FIA basically means the floating intra-articular fragments. So it's a burst kind of an injury which happens in the distal radius here. Again, the teardrop here and the anteroposterior diameter is completely increased here. So these are things which you need to find out. And if you start looking sequentially, you will know where is the problem in this. And again, you need flexibility in approaches here, where you want to go. And even in the implants is paramount, because finally it's an intraoperative decision what you want to do with this. What are the options to catch these fragments when you have a burst fracture like this? Again, if at all you have a dedicated implant, like the rim plates like this. The beauty of the rim plates is it can cross the watershed line. And it's got a very low profile distally so that it can cross the watershed line and you don't get tendon irritation here. So there are various designs available here where it's got an extra flange on this side, both sides. But the important thing is this. Your screws here go proximally here. They don't go distally like your regular ulnar plate. They go proximal, they're directed proximally here, and that is how you catch these fragments. So this is the important thing which you always notice in these patients. So this is again a rim plate, and we have again used a fragment-specific plate in this patient. This is 6 months later. The articular surface is reasonably well-formed here. And then this is 1 year later. And this is again a 2 years later. This is a follow-up. If you see the articular surface, which was the initial burst kind of an injury, has reasonably formed nicely here. Only disadvantage here in these kind of situations is you can't really get that ulnar tilt in a burst kind of an injury or a rim fractures. Up to neutral is actually a good result here. To recreate that ulnar or a palma tilt is very, very difficult when you have a lot of these fragments damaged. There's another case, again, underestimating these fractures is a problem always. So this absolutely no hold here, no screws were put. They thought it was only a buttress is good enough here, but then it jumps, it escapes, especially from the ulnar side, it completely comes out. So these are the common complications with this kind of fractures. So know the configuration, the pattern of this, where these fragments are, where this is the dorsal wall. Is it the free intra-articular fragments? Is it the radial column? Is it the ulnar rim? Or is it the dorsal ulnar corner? These are the ones which are damaged here. And that's basically because if you see, it's where the ligaments are attached. You have the short and the long radial lunate ligaments. You have the radioscaphocapitate ligaments. You have the dorsal radiocarpal ligaments here. So these are the ones which are pulling off these fragments. And that is where the energy is dissipating. And that's when you get this kind of pattern here. So basically, it's a soft tissue, a massive soft tissue injury, which has happened here in rim fractures. And when you have these soft tissue injuries, you have to cross this watershed line to go all the way to catch them. So it no longer remains sarcosang. And you have to, as I said, cross this line, but by keeping low profile, having dedicated implants. Again, same kind of approach. a lot of times you might really not be able to put in screws. You might have to use other techniques like using a suture through the distal holes here and taking the entire capsule along these small fragments there and holding on to these plates. So these are the techniques you'll have to use in these kind of fractures. Other options, again, if you don't have those rim plates, there are ways to do it. You can again reduce it in whatever ways you want and make sure you subchondrally support this entire fragment, put in additional screws if you want to catch all these fragments, and then put in your regular juxtaarticular kind of plates. Again, if it is really badly comminuted there, you have done your fragment specific fixation or even a regular plate. But then if you want to hold the whole thing, as I said, it's a massive soft tissue injury, also capsular injury, ligamentous injury. One of the way we used to do earlier was to put an X-fix and hold it. And the, now the new concept is basically the bridge plating or an internal distraction plate. So you would put this inside and you would hold this so that you don't have to put an external fixator with all its complications, pin track and other things. So you can keep this for about 3 months, 4 months. And once these fracture heals, this plate can be removed. So that is the best way of doing these very high energy injuries. And the role of external fixator is obviated. The third scenario is where I'm talking of those with carpal instabilities. So if you look at this is a pre-op X-ray, if you carefully look, this is an intra-articular fracture here. Almost, it's burst open here. You want the ulna styloid, but again, carefully look one joint above here, you would see the space, the scapholunate space is opened up in this patient. And that is the 3D-CT picture of the same patient. And you know where these fragments are coming out and how it is formed. But again, you can see the scapholunate space is increased in this. This is at the time of close reduction intraoperatively, reasonable reduction, but there is some depression here. But the most important step you need to do is to screen intraoperatively. When you screen this patient, you see this gap increasing. Always, always do this. Screen this wrist always after you fix your distal radius fracture. Sometimes scaphoid fracture suddenly opens up. Sometimes you see this scapholunate kind of injuries, which can be seen very clearly in these patients. I think am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
I think it just
the. Yeah, you can go back to the same slide again. Yeah, you exited from the PowerPoint.
Yeah. Just give me a minute, sir.
Yeah, fine. I think you have to close it and open because this is a. Meanwhile, we can take some question. Amit, Bharat, Asim, you have any question to ask meanwhile? You have to unmute. Amit, please unmute yourself. Yes.
Automatically, the English word. 80% of it is Hebrew Arabic. Remaining. I changed Bharat, that to Hebrew. Second answer for example.
You are from behind in your in with you. Bharat.
Yeah, fine.
Yes, Amit.
Anil.
Yeah.
The common question is, yeah, it was really great listening to you as always. Well, what are your indications for carpal tunnel release at the time when you plan your management of distal radius fractures? That's what most of them would like to know.
Okay. One minute, Bharat. I'll just...
Sure.
He's not used to multitasking.
No, I need to give the right, correct answer. So I'm just concentrating on my slide being back.
That's fine.
So is my screen seen now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Slideshow.
Okay. Well, carpal tunnel release, basically a lot of times when I'm doing the lunate facet kind of an injury, I would not hesitate to release the carpal tunnel at that time itself. Because again, these are high energy injuries there, my plate is going there. And so I would prefer that the carpal tunnel is released there. That is one of the primary indication. Otherwise, routinely, I would not do that. So if yes. I'm in that area and my implant is going there, yes. I would not release halfway through and keep quiet. That is not the thing. It can cause more constriction on the nerve. So you as well release the whole thing because definitely postoperatively you will have fracture edema and so many things. So better is to release the entire transverse carpal ligament at that point.
So most often, once the reduction is done, the symptoms come down, you know, median of symptoms.
And yeah.
If you release it completely, yes.
Correct. That is a learning point. If you release it completely, not halfway through there. Yeah. Shall I go ahead?
No. Can we take one or two questions, relevant questions? In your carpotunnel release approach, do you release the pronator quadratus from the ulnar side? And some people use both the windows, then you can't really release the pronator quadratus from the ulnar side as well as on the radial side. How do you handle that? I was watching one of the videos from those Starboard. He said that you can use both the windows. I understand we normally cut it on the radial side, and you can do the same thing from the, you peel it off from the ulnar side. But how can you use both the windows?
Two ways, sir. One is you are just doing only the medial side dissection. You are not going anywhere near the lateral side. You are dead in the center there, and you are just releasing only that area along with your carpotunnel release.
That will work,
The other way is basically you're going all the way from the radial side, releasing and stripping off completely till you see the fragment. So you're not actually erasing the ulnar attachment there. You're just trying to retract the whole muscle as much as possible.
But you can't cut it from both the ends, obviously.
No. Yeah, definitely.
Another question was, I saw one of your x-rays. I use rim plate in few patients. If you ask them to get it removed, once they are fine, they are not very keen for a second surgery. So at 2 years, you showed a patient with a rim plate. So are there any problems?
No, if it is a very proper rim plate, actually, and if it's not causing any irritation, we don't really advise implant removal. But we know that the plate is proud, that we go by what's called the Soames criteria. So when we know the plate is proud, those are the patients already counseled that you need to come back very regularly, and there might be a chance that you need a plate removal. But otherwise, if it is sitting nicely in flush with the rim there and it's not causing irritation, you don't have to really go and remove that. Yes. And anytime patients come back, the one option is always do an ultrasound and see what's happening to the tendons. So if at all patient has any kind of symptoms, the best is to do an ultrasound and see what's happening to the tendons and how the gliding is happening.
Between ultrasound and an MRI, what will be your choice? Because ultrasound is highly person dependent.
Yes, but in this situation, I want a dynamic status. So I want an ultrasound to see how the tendons are gliding, whether it's hitching onto the plate or not. That's very important.
Your rich plate patient, you chose to do it on the second. So how do you decide whether to put it on the second or the third metacarp?
No, that's purely an intraoperative decision where...
How do you decide that?
It's like the convenience itself. How much you've exposed, where you've exposed, and where you want the major stabilization to happen. Yes. So it just goes by that. There is no specific indication that it has to go on second or third. Absolutely not.
But majority of the people put it on the third, if I've seen the x-ray.
It's more convenient to put it in that way. Okay. Yes.
Do you ever combine your volar plate with an X-fix rather than a dorsal fixation?
I used to do it earlier, but now I prefer more of just adding a K-wire with a plate instead of an X-fix. So if I find a situation where my plate is not enough and I need to hold some fragment, I would put a K-wire rather than going for an X-fix. Yes. So I would hold those with just the K-wires. Yes.
Does that external fixator cause so much of problem, what you are telling? Because it's only wall distraction. If the people do it with external fixator, then there will be RSD and the stiffness. But if you hold the external fixator for about 3 to 4 weeks properly, then release the traction, all this majority of these comminuted fractures can be treated with external fixator. That's what I feel.
Yes, sir. I mean, we have done it earlier. We used to do it earlier also. But we are talking about a situation of a rim fracture here.
Yeah.
And these situations, we need the external fixator for a longer time. And that's when the internal distraction plate concept has come. So that we don't keep it for months together. Yes, that is very important. Yeah. 3 weeks won't be enough, sir. 3 weeks won't be enough.
Neil, sir.
Yes.
I was listening to one of the debates between Paul Tonetan and other tycoon. So this fellow spoke in favor of X-fix. But all his X-fix could keep the wrist in dorsiflexion. So do we have any excellent fixator in our country which allow us to use and hold the whole thing in, construct in 10 degree of dorsiflexion? Do we have those?
Asim, yes. Then I will dig my presentation, I'll immediately prepare. After sir's lecture, I'll continue with the short presentation.
Yes. The orthofix fixators come with the hinge joint, which can be used. Even with the JES, you can modify that with a joint there, and can change the angle with the for dorsiflexion with this. If you've seen one of my X-rays, I've used the combination was K wires and X fix. I used to use orthofix very frequently. We still have those old orthofix, and that's got a joint, and that can be loosened and mobilized nicely, but also you can give the dorsiflexion, palmar flexion, whichever you want that. A little expensive, definitely.
Yes. The concern, Anil, with this distraction plate, you know, in specific indications where you use it for 3 long months, you know,
that yeah.
give a cause
yeah.
for concern as far as the wrist stiffness is
concerned. I mean, the proper ones are quite low profile. And yes. generally don't have much problem. And you know that you have to remove them. Patient knows about it, you have to remove them. So in that way, it is known that there will be a kind of expectation that this will be removed. So anything happens, patient has any irritation or anything, they come back very soon. And anyway, you will be following up these patients at least every 6 weeks at that point. So otherwise, there's no major concern as long as it's kept low profile. Yes.
Yeah, only the concern is the stiffness of the wrist because you keep it for 3 to 4 months.
3 to 4 months, but invariably with the kind of rim fractures they have, they do have some stiffness later also. Even if you had not used the plate, there would be some stiffness. You have to get rid of it with a prolonged physiotherapy. Yes.
So what is the treatment protocol percentage of X-fix you're using nowadays compared to 1.5 decades earlier?
I think it's drastically reduced.
Yes.
Yes. Less than 10%. Yes.
Yeah. With the convenience of early mobilization, I think everyone should remember that it has definitely come down compared to what used to be 1 to 1.5 decades earlier.
Correct. With availability of all these anatomical plates and so many specific plates, yeah, definitely X-fix, the role has come down, but it can be still used. Anyway, let him continue and finish, then we can take all the discussion.
Okay.
Yes, sir, please proceed.
Yes. So this is the same patient with the instability. Fix the radius. And then I've used this wire there. But then the most important thing is to fix the scapholunate joint. And the first step for any fixation of scapholunate is to make sure that lunate is neutral position. So one of the wires you pass is the radiolunate wire here as a temporary way. Keep it in neutral position. And then you put in your scapholunate wire here. Because if you just put only the scapholunate wire here, this lunate gets pushed. Plus it can go either dorsal or volar kind of a thing. So this radiolunate wire is very important for you to keep it in that neutral position for you to transfix this. The other wire you put is a scaphocapitate wire because the scaphoid has a tendency to flex. So you would put a scaphocapitate wire here, a scapholunate wire here, and then again check and see. Now the whole thing is moving as a single unit. So this is a very important step again. So this, you transfix the scapholunate wire here, joint here. And the lunate is sitting right in the center in a neutral position. It's very, very important point when you do this reduction. This patient also had ulnar stylet fracture. We have fixed that. And then we have fixed this distal radial joint, transfixed it. So a simple distal radius fracture is always not so simple in the sense that you need to look at one joint above here, one joint below here. And the entire construct is required for these kind of patients. Otherwise, a lot of times the plate is put, patient comes back with pain because patient has scapholunate instability here or a DRUG instability. So these are the complications we see a lot of times in these patients. So the learning point here is every distal radius fracture is an intra-articular fracture in that sense because the distal radius is a part of a big joint here, the entire forearm joint here. And as I said, we have to have this vision when you treat the distal radius, not just looking at the radius here, but you need to look at all these areas here for this. And that is the way the concept of arthroscopic assisted intra-articular fixation has come into picture. And why would I do this procedure? It's to assist and correct the intra-articular step off or a gap after the manipulation, reduction, and provisional fixation. It gives me an opportunity to identify any associated ligamentous or chondral damage and its management. And arthroscopy basically complements your fluoroscopy. It will show you articular combination, any depressed or rotated fragments. Rotated fragments are very important, which you see only through arthroscope. any gap, any chondral and ligamentous damage here. The basic steps are same. You go with close manipulation to assess the fracture reduction and stability. This is the fracture here, close reduction done here. Then the next is a provisional fixation with either K-wire or a mini open reduction with a plate. So this, I'm using a K-wire. I've also used a mini open reduction here. Put a plate, just put the screw here, one single screw here, and held it here like this. So this technique is called as a plate presetting arthroscopic reduction technique, or also called as a PART, described by the Japanese. The small opening is made, and provisionally you put in a plate there, and then you proceed to arthroscopy here. The classic is 3, 4, 4, 5, and 6 are portals here. The first step is there'll be a lot of hematoma inside and the debris to be removed. Assessment of intercarpal ligament injuries and the chondral injury debridement. Assess the articular surface, elevate any depressed fragments, close gaps, and evaluate the TFCC ligament. So a standard wrist arthroscopy, I usually use a Smux bandage here because compartment syndrome is a complication. The fluid intra-articular fractures, when you put in the fluid here, it extravasates into the forearm. So apply a Smux there, so that will prevent the extravasation. And once you've cleared the debris and hematoma there, a dry scopy is good enough. A lot of times we use without any fluid inside the joint. And this is a small video of how we do this. It's an intra-articular distal radius fractures. The moment you enter the joint, you see there's a lot of hematoma at the fracture site. It's all hazy inside. So you need to wash them off. You need to flush it. You can use additional syringe and then flush off all these hematoma, and then things start becoming more and more visible here. And then you start seeing the fracture lines. You provisionally fixed it already with either a plate or a K-wire. And then you start seeing the fracture fragments, and then you identify where these fracture fragments are. So you would have seen in your CT where this are. So you probe them, these fracture fragments, and see whether your fixation is good enough. Is there any gap there? Is it moving abnormally? So all those things, your probe is basically, this is about 3 millimeters. So your gap should not be, ideally for a distal radius, they say 2 millimeter step off. So that's what we're trying to aim at here in this kind of a situation. You're clearing the hematoma here, you use a shaver and take off all these so that it becomes much more clear. And this is a scaphoid here on the top here, and this is a distal radius here. You check for the scapulonate ligament status, and then you come down and then you use your shaver basically to clear all these debris. The moment you do that, the fracture site becomes much more clear for you. So this is a step which tells you exactly whether your provisional reduction is good enough and you can go ahead, or you need to do any kind of adjustments here. So once that's done, so you see now the styloid fragment is quite unstable here, which was fixed by K-wire. So you will have to see that, and if it is unstable, you withdraw the K-wire there and try to fix this now under vision. You try to fix this properly here. So this is the fragment here. This was the radial styloid fragment here. Just an attempt is being made now to fix this. The first attempt at reduction, your K-wire is trying to come in, but it's actually distracting it. So you need to hold that fragment down, and otherwise you'll have to hold it from outside. So sometimes we use the AO clamps, the tinaculum kind of clamps, and hold this together. And my assistant is using the tinaculum clamp here and trying to hold this and trying to push that fragment back here. So a lot of times we don't, in a C-arm, if you see, it looks reduced actually, this entire fragment, but actually it might not, this kind of a gap will be there, this kind of a step will be there. So by about second attempt, you can easily make out that this can be reduced and nicely put back here. Okay, it goes and sits into this the jigsaw puzzle here nicely here. And then you need to check whether it's moving, whether there's a gap there or not. So this is one example of reduction of one of the fragments. A lot of times we do it on the lunate facet side or sometimes even on the dorsal side. So this is what you see. And once that is done, you check for ulnar rim here to see for any injuries there. So you can't basically see the dorsal side, but you can see the ulnar side easily with the arthroscope here. And then you go towards the ulnar side now, that is a lunate at the top there. You go towards the ulnar side. That is the lunate facet itself, looks nice, clear, there's no injury there. And then you come towards more ulnar side, you will start seeing the lunate triquetral ligament. So that's the lunate. And as we come towards the ulnar side, this is the LT ligament. There is some small flap which has come out of that. nothing clinically important. If at all you want, you can just shave it off, but otherwise you can. So these are all, so many injuries can be there, but doesn't mean that they're all clinically significant. Doesn't mean that all these has to be done routinely. No, it's just an additional skill. It's just an additional way of looking at things. And then if you want, you can debride. And the most important thing is the TFCC. So again, literature says that acute fractures show almost 65%, 60 to 65% of TFCC injuries. Doesn't mean that we should go and treat all these TFCC injuries. Simple immobilization or a transfixation with K-wire is good enough for most of them to heal. And there's no hard evidence to say that people have not done acute, MRI in acute cases, then gone and seen in arthroscopically. That kind of studies are not there still. And this is TFCC again. If you see some laxity, this is the ligaments, volar ligaments. And this is the trampoline sign, what I'm doing. That is the there's some laxity of this, but there's no tear as such. So these are the things we look at during the arthroscopic assisted kind of fixation. There's a steep learning curve here. As I said, compartment syndrome is one of the problems. Technical difficulties to do inadequate visualization, cumbersome, and operating time constraints are always there and added cost for the patient. What's the current evidence for this? Most level one studies indicate better radiographic alignment, better wrist motion, but not better wrist scores as such. Ligament injuries, again, no hard evidence on improved outcomes after repairs. The AAOS clinical guidelines say as it has got a weak evidence to support its use. But my philosophy is basically if a method produces better results, one must master any difficulty it presents and learn to do it well. So it's an additional skill. If you have it, yes, you can do it and you can see the benefits of it sometimes. The guidelines in this pandemic for colis fracture, well, closed fractures and uncomplicated fractures, close reduction cast followed up by telemedicine service, that is what is advised. Complications are expected. As I said, complications are expected when you do this. Please document this because, as I said, there will be a cohort of patients coming back after 6 months with a lot of complications. And if you have not documented, you will be in trouble. Open fractures, carpal dislocations, which require emergency surgeries, make sure you take all the standard precautions. Use absorbable sutures so that patients doesn't come back. Use transparent dressings to avoid unnecessary follow-ups. Pediatric fractures, families, if you put a splint or a slab, family can remove them at 6 weeks and a telemedicine kind of a follow-up. This is the basic guidelines for distal radius fractures in this. One thing probably I would take the liberty is we are going back to close reduction and the cast application, the art of cast application is fading slowly. And I would probably, there are enough postgraduates watching it. I would want to stress few of these points, how to put a good cast. Keep all your things ready, then good use always a good stock in it. I see a lot of times the cast is applied without a stock in it there, and directly plasters are applied, sharp edges are seen. So always make sure that you apply a good length of stock in it and make sure this will cushion the entire area for the patient, makes it much more comfortable for the patient. And then once your cotton roll is applied, your roller bandage comes in, always check that the MCP joints are free. And once you apply your first layer of plaster, the most important thing I would like to assess is how your joints are, especially the MCP joints and especially this thumb area. Folding the stock in it is very important. No sharp edges here. That's the most important thing. First, web space is very important here. Trim it, cut off the extra plaster there so that your first web space is not compromised. This is what I'm trying to impress upon, that the cast should not cross the distal palmar crease. If you see your MCPs actually flex at the distal palmar crease, which means to say that your MCPs have, this is a most common complication we see with distal radius fractures and cast. The MCPs have to be free. The cast should stop here. It should not extend beyond the distal palmar crease. And you see this arch, this angle here. This is how the MCPs flex actually. So it should not be straight like this. The thumb again, the stockinet has to open up here so that the thumb moves very easily here. These are the points I would like to make for a cast. It's slightly out of the flow, but I want to impress upon the younger generation, clean the fingers always. Don't allow the patient to go with a lot of plasters there. You want to check for circulation and so many things. So these are very, very important for you to make this. If you use a synthetic cast, fold the stockinet in the first place itself and then apply the entire layer there. And again, make sure MCP joints are completely free for the patient. Otherwise, these patients will always come back with stiffness. This pandemic is also taught us to go back to Kohli's and Chanley's methods of basic skills. This is, if you see, it's a lunate facet fracture actually. But again, patient was not willing for any surgery. We were also not keen. We somehow thought, okay, we'll just do a percutaneous kind of a fixation here. And I put a wire here to hold this here, another wire to hold this here. Scaphoid lunate joint also was disrupted. At 3 months, it's holding nicely here. There's no depression here. And we are following up this patient. So what I'm trying to make is point is that you're the archer and you know what to use and you need to know how to use these implants with you. So the implant is chosen based on the fracture pattern and your expertise. And we should not be blaming the implants. We should not be blaming X-FITs or K-wires because we chose it in a wrong way. And the soft tissue respect is very, very important. And as I said, you are, as a surgeon, much more important than what implant you're choosing. So stability of the fracture itself, what is unstable fracture, what is unstable fixations, the concept of one joint above, one joint below. Non-operative treatment requires a careful follow-up every week in the first 3 weeks. Operative treatment, judicious use of implant, whichever you choose, the concept of watershed line, the lunate facet, the intra-op radiology for projecting screws either into the joint dorsally, the screening of the the wrist joint, the DRUJ stability, all these, please do not forget when you're operating all these. Check all these before you come out of this. Now, the present treatment strategy, this is a little philosophical because treatment is surgeon centric. We tell the patient what is good, what is bad. Even our patients tell, please, you choose what is important. And patient is minimally involved in decision making except when it comes to the finance. Otherwise, patients hardly come to picture here. And we never ask the patient actually what the patient wants. What is their experience about the whole treatment process? And a lot of times when we are doing a study on a qualitative study on distal radius, and the answers are really surprising. Even the most educated people will tell, I was not told the options. My entire process of this operative was not really good. So these are the things which we get. So patient involvement, patient shared decision, especially in a distal radius where you have so many implants, so many choices. I think this is a very important thing. The other thing, this is my appeal to Dr. Shivshankar, the data is the new gold. And there's a huge opportunity to give massive data from India. I'm sure every surgeon operates so much of distal radius. We are doing so much of joint replacements. So much of data is there in our country. And the need of the hour is a registry system. A very simple distal radius, as I said, absolutely no epidemiological data from India, nothing major. It's very surprising when we found out that there is no epidemiological data from India at all. There's one small hospital-based one or two studies, that's it. Otherwise, there is nothing. So each society, we have so many societies, we have so many associations, even if they can adopt one particular kind of a condition, an arthroplasty, a distal radius, and they can develop this registry, I think we can beat the world with the amount of data we have. And as we were talking last year, sir, I mean, you are a private practitioner, but I saw how much of academic involvement you had. You were talking about syllabus, you were talking about PG syllabus and everything. And I think with your enthusiasm, I think this can be taken up. Registry systems can be established in all the societies and huge data can be generated from what we are doing in our country. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. That was an excellent exposure to all the varieties of fractures of the distal end of radius and all the modes of treatment, including plastering to arthroscopic assisted. So if you have some burning questions, we'll take. Otherwise, I'll show some slides about, yes, Asim. Then I'll show my external fixation. Yes, Asim, you have to unmute.
You talked about choosing the right implant. So we all know that Synthes and all these bigger companies, they have shifted from older designs to newer designs where the footprint on the lateral side towards the steroid is less. So the FPL is spared. But there are lots of Indian copies which really do not follow that. So will you just elaborate on that? You flittingly talked about the choosing the right implant, but will you make it very clear for the layperson? The older plates were going right up to here. And now they have become sort of less prominent here, and they cover more on the lunette fossa. And correct. The spread screws, they tend to go obliquely.
Correct. I mean, if you look at the market, I think it's mind-boggling the amount of types of implants we have, the copies we have. So there's no way there's any control on these kind of things. And if, as I, that's why I said, it's the archer which who's important rather than the arrow itself, which means to say that we need to know what is good for that particular patient. Even with the, I don't want to name the companies, but even with the synthesis, I'm not happy with the way it projects onto the radial styloid area.
Yes,
it's quite very high profile. It's quite thick. A lot of patients come and tell me that there is a prominence here, which they don't like. So even if it's a good strong plate, still it might not be really anatomical in that sense. The second thing is when you have a copy, yes, if it's a good copy, it's fine. But a lot of times, again, we get stuck somewhere, especially during the locking screws. Half of these, just they don't go and you're stuck halfway through. You don't can't come out, you can't go out. So these are the difficulties when you have, when we choose. I know the finance is a big thing. I mean, that's a totally different thing. And we have to talk about it sometimes in the background of that for choosing an implant. But and it plays a huge role in our setup in India, at least. But otherwise, what I'm saying is that in the reasonable choices what we have, looking at the fracture pattern and analyzing it carefully will give you that guideline beforehand. Intraoperatively, when you do a close reduction, screen the wrist. That is, again, you can change your decision. And those are the times you can actually change your implants whenever possible. And I believe strongly in a hybrid kind of fixation a lot of times. Even if I'm doing this in good molar locking plate, I don't hesitate putting another K-wire there and holding that most important fragment, which none of my plate screws are catching. So it's very important for those kind of things. That's why I said choosing that implant is very, very important.
Yes, Amit.
Yeah. You spoke about the conservative management. So you showed below elbow cast. When do you go above elbow?
Above elbow for me is purely when the DRUJ is involved. Otherwise, most of the times, it's always a below elbow cast. So if the DRUJ is involved, 3 weeks of above elbow cast in whatever position the DRUJ is reducing. Most of the time, it falls back in supination, but it can be just about neutral also. And then I would put the cast in that particular position. And 3 weeks later, we start mobilizing them with a split. So that's what I do.
And when do you go dorsal?
Dorsal for the plate fixation?
Yes.
Yes. Dorsal for me is, as I showed you, that shaded area where I showed you is purely dorsal lunate fragment. And that is one where it has gone, you know, more than 50% of it. It's extending into the sigmoid notch. And that's where I want to buttress it from the dorsal aspect. So that is one clear indication. Otherwise, a lot of times, a volar plate is good enough for me. There are a lot of surgeons who like the dorsal plates, who like the lateral plates for these kind of fragments. But for me, that dorsal lunate fragment, which is completely away from the main bone, I think that is the one indication for me. If you want to ask one single indication, yes.
If you have put a dorsal plate, when do you remove it?
With the present plates, it's not a major concern. You're not elevating the Lister's tubercle. You have two plates if you want to use one on both sides of Lister's with an L-shaped kind of a configuration. They're really low profile, no tendon irritation. And try to exteriorize the tendon by putting the extensor retinaculum over the plate. So when you do that, you really don't have to remove these plates.
While going dorsal, do you do a Lister's tubercle osteotomy? Or you
no.
Don't?
No, okay. We don't. We don't.
Yes, Asif.
Yeah. Sir, you talked about the plate standoff. You showed the drawing also and other things. A few words about volar translation maneuver for reducing the fracture and the lift technique. How often you use the lift technique? I'm extremely fond of it. I put all my screws parallel to subchondral thing and just then bring the metafascial fragment over the diaphysis. So how do you exactly go about it? Just elaborate it for the audience.
Yeah. For me,
reduce the fracture and just put the plate.
So once the reduction is done and the plate is applied, for me, the wrist has to come towards the plate, right? That is the most important thing. So I need to reduce the fracture to the plate. It's not the other way. right? So my hand is here and I'm using my drill and then I'm using my screwdriver, but my other hand is right there, or my assistant has to be pushing here. So they should not be pushing here. A lot of times that's what happens. People will not do this. They should be holding here at the wrist itself and trying to push the fragment back. So that is a very important step for you to get that palmar tilt back. So you're trying to get the fracture towards the plate, trying to keep it in palmar flexion. And if you keep your own hand otherwise, then you know that, especially when you're passing your drill, you know where it's hitting. That's another, a proprioceptive kind of a feedback you're getting for your own way, how you're drilling. So that's again very important. So with those two maneuvers, you would always get that palmar tilt back. If not palmar tilt, at least you'll get your neutral back, definitely, in these situations.
Lift technique.
Yes, lift technique we will discuss. I have got a case to present on that.
Probably malunion and other scenarios, probably it will come later, I think.
Yes. Sir, before I present this case, I would like you to study this case, because you are a high volume and you are working in a medical college, and since you are only looking after the hand and wrist injuries, so I wish that you can give this as a thesis to one of your students. This technique I am using for the last almost 30 years and it has given me very good results. And it is very, very economical. So, as you said, this commonly used external fixator, either you have to fix the fragment with a K-wire or there should be a hinge. Without that, you can see that there is translation happening. So, with the uniplanar fixator. And otherwise, you have to use the hinge as well as K-wire. So, this is the hybrid way of fixing. Other option is use very cumbersome external fixator like a L0 or even a Jess you can use. But they are all time consuming and so many things you have to look after that. So what I am describing is a very economical fixator. There are only four shunt pins, two in the second metacarpal and two in the proximal middle third radius junction. And there are only five clamps and two connecting rods. Since they make an angle of about 120 degree to 90 to 120 degree between these two wire, a shunt pin, it gives a quadrilateral fixation. It's not a uniplanar fixator. So it's a quadriplanar, much more stronger fixator. And earlier I was using a radial and a ulnar fixator, and we were connecting them externally with the connecting rod. So you can see that from 8 shunt pin, we have come down to 4 shunt pin. From 12 clamps here, we have come down to only 5 clamps here, and 4 connecting rods too, we have come down to 2 connecting rods, giving probably much more versatile fixation, which is much more stronger, and you can give the position. What Dr. Asim was telling, we cannot give palmar tilt. We can give palmar flexion. We can give palmar tilt. If you want a dorsal tilt or any other position also, you can just loosen the distal to escalap clamps, give that position and just tighten it. So whatever position you want to give, keep the wrist, you can use in this position. So these are some of the pictures I'm rushing through. A comminuted fracture, you can see that beautifully it has got aligned. And this patient, you can see, this is how the hand looks. And we cut the extra length of the shunt pin so that they are much more comfortable. And here you can see the patient using the hand, and they can move, they can flex, extend fully. None of the tendons get impaled if you are taken care properly. And the patient can use the hand very comfortably. You can see in this picture, the patient is lifting the chair. They can use the hand for their daily work. So that's not an issue. And the same lady, which I had treated in 2015, I called her back for one of my presentation, 2019. Such a full function. Even I took an X-ray. You can see this is the left side I have operated. If I measure all the angles, it has restored back normally, just with external fixator. I normally keep this fixator in little distracted mode for 3 weeks time. Then at 3 weeks, I reduce the distraction, I loosen the clamps and reduce the distractor and keep it for another 3 weeks time. Here you can see a volar Barton fragment, a comminuted radial fragment. I have not over distracted. What you are talking with the external distract fixator, we had to over distract. No, you press the fragment back in position, keep it in neutralized position. See, this is 6203. This is 7203. Immediate postoperative. I have not distracted the joint. Yes, I do agree that people distract the joint and that's the problem for RSD. But it is not necessary in all the cases to distract or distract. See, this is in April, just before the fixator was removed. And this is follow-up in May. Beautiful restoration of the whole function in that guy. Another patient, father of two doctors, both his sons are doctor, daughter-in-laws are doctor. They are practicing in Nagpur at present. So again, you can see that this is in 2010, I had treated this patient with fixator. In 2014, there is excellent function in that person. These are some of the scars of the pins, which we can see. This is the final picture after 4 years. All the joints, everything has been beautifully restored. Another badly comminuted, you can see there is a lunar fragment, there is a radial stylet present, volar fragment. See, this is the restoration just in external fixator. This patient also had a pelvic injury. And this is subsequent picture, you can see the restoration of all the, everything. Again, you can see in this case here, there is a flake in the volar aspect, which has come back in total position. This wire is, I'm fixing the ulnar stylet process. It's not the fixing the fragment. I could incorporate it with a just clamp into my fixator also. And such a beautiful outcome you can get even in such bad comminuted fractures. This is another die punch fracture you can see. Again, just by distraction. You can see this is where I have over-distracted initially. I over-distract initially. Once it comes back in position, I just reduce the distraction and the patient gets good result. This patient has come 3 weeks later, a badly comminuted fracture. I applied the fixator and I was not happy. Distal radiolar joint is not at all in position. So I just removed the clamps, applied uniplanar just fixator, turnbuckle fixator, and I distracted the joint. Now you can see that even at 3 weeks time, in a 75-year-old lady, I could distract it and get back the position of the joint beautifully. Once it got aligned, then I applied back the fixator. And this is another lady. Again, you can see 75 lady with 2 weeks old fracture. Again, similar fracture I've treated, bilateral fractures. Multiple, I have done so many cases, but I have not kept a record of all the people, measurement, everything I have not done. But I wish that somebody, you can take this as a thesis for your student. I can give all the data with me and that will be really useful to work on. Yes, you can ask some questions before we proceed further. Yes, Bharat.
Sir, the only concern is because of the fixator, when the patient is on this fixator, is it possible for them to do the supination, pronation?
Yes, they will do. Yes, they may not be doing 100%, but at least 50-70% they'll be doing.
Yeah. Have you seen long-term restriction in supination and pronation in these patients?
No, I have not seen any restriction because I've been using since, I was working as lecturer in 1992 in a government hospital in Solapur. Then I was doing the fixator and suddenly the clamps were not fitting to the chance pin or the connecting rods. So we were held up with only 4 or 5 of them working properly. Though we had about 10 to 12 on the table, nothing worked. Then Dr. Barve, he was assisting me. He's a joint replacement surgeon now in Pune, Raghav Barve. He said, sir, we'll connect in this X fashion. So we just connected. Since we had already applied ulnar rod and radial shunt pin, we just connected in that fashion. We had another clamp which was still extra so that we connected the rod with that. And that patient did so well. I started doing this as a routine because from 12 clamps, we came back to 5 clamps. So that time we were not having all these plates and other thing. So then I liked this technique so much that I started propagating. Many of my friends in Solapur, they do this. Yeah.
What intra-articular fractures?
Yeah. Intra-articular fracture, I distract on table and just press from dorsal and ventral aspect and then fix it in little reduced traction. I distract fully. Then apply the fixator, confirm that they're in position, then reduce slightly. Then by about 3 weeks time, when they come for follow-up, I'll reduce it still more. And I normally remove them about 6 to 7 weeks in there. Yeah.
Yeah, because most of these intra-articular fractures are known to collapse up to 3 months after. So that was the concern. Because we removed it 6 weeks.
Longer duration of time in them. I have shown enough number of cases with final results. That's why. Yes, Asim. Yes, Asim.
No. Do you combine this with K-wires? Percutaneous
K-wires? Very rarely I combine because I get the reduction reasonably acceptable. That's why I don't combine. I have done combination, not much.
Yes, question.
Yes, Amit.
Any kind of case you won't do this? Like you've not wanted to do this?
I have not encountered anything so much. But nowadays, with the availability of such a good locking plates, Olar buttons, I tend to plate more often than using extreme fixator. I was using this fixator earlier. I have got good results. That's not the... Because even I can keep there in palmar flexion position in that fixator. So, but nowadays, I tend to use more plate in such patient. Olar button. Yeah.
No, God forbid, it should not happen. But if today... You have a fracture, intra-articular. So what
definitely would be? I'll come to you or I'll come to Anil, but I cannot operate myself.
No. Conservative treatment or a plating?
No. I would like the treating surgeon. I leave it to me. Do whatever you want to do. I don't want to put my head in that.
Anil, sir. When do you use bone graft or chronos? Any place for bone grafting or bone substitute in your patients?
Yeah, Anil Bhatt.
No, sir. Actually, in acute situations, I've never used a bone graft. I mean, it's a surprising answer probably for many, but then I'm a little averse in, especially even for the bone substitute also. But we've not had a situation where we actually, especially after the locking plates have come, I don't see any necessity of using a bone graft. In fact, even malunions nowadays, I don't use bone grafts. We have a huge series coming up and we'll be sending it for publication. But then, I mean, that's out of this question. But even then, I'm not using bone graft with a lock plate.
Yes, Asim.
For the elevation of the impacted or the depressed fragments, what is the better... side, is it better from the Vora side or is it from the dorsal side? And I saw that you are more in favor of Volar. So the depressed fragments are generally in the lunate column, and can you easily do it from the Volar side?
Yeah, I mean, it's always an intrafocal kind of a reduction which we follow. We go through the fracture site, take that as an advantage, and most of the times it's possible on the Volar side. So unless, as I said, if you have a pure dorsal lunate kind of a fragment there, that is where you have to go that other side. But otherwise, a lot of times your Olar approach that gives you a ready-made access to the intra-articular element also. So an intrafocal kind of a reduction can be done and you can elevate those fragments. The moment I do that, I would pass my, I mean, that's my favorite technique of just passing the raft wires, hold it there. And then I can go back and put in my plate.
Yes. This is the case, Dr. Rajendra Chandak from Nagpur Ascent. Distal radius plate, lift up the depressed fragment using the lift up plate technique. So you can see that a plate can be applied at an angle, then the distal screws can be applied. And then by taking the plate back to the bone, you can get a beautiful reduction at the articular surface. This is a fractured distal end of the radius. There is a dorsal piece and there is a volar piece. Amit, what you will do? This is what all the picture we have got. Since it is in the lift up, you can make it that lift up technique has been used, but anything else?
Look, the volar side, the continuity of the volar radius is quite good. On the lateral view, Shiva,
volar
continuity is very good. Volar side, just below, that continuity is very good. So I think volar plate in this case would not, the main fracture fragment is dorsal, and these are dorsal articular fragments. These are rim fragments. And I think here you have to go dorsally. It's probably the dorsal capsule which has got avulsed, and you have to get the dorsal capsule back, and if needed, do a dorsal plate.
Okay. Yes, Bharat, you want to add anything, or Asim?
Absolutely, I agree with Dr. Rajgaonkar that concerning its dorsal combination, there is a possibility that it can subflux dorsally also. So I would certainly prefer a dorsal plating in this particular fracture.
Okay, since both have given the same answer, I will not ask anybody else now. So it's a zoomed picture of the same fracture. This is the CT. So we can see that there is a dorsal fragment, ulnar fragment. This is the lift up technique. So the distally the screws are applied, then gradually this screw is applied. So this was treated. I think it is probably different X-ray. I don't think.
Different one, yeah.
Yeah.
Because that first X-ray was totally different.
Yeah, totally different. Yes, I do agree. These are the screws, the what already Dr. Anil Bhatt has explained, to see that they are not impinging. Because here we cannot see that combination dorsally, which was seen earlier.
Yeah, correct, yeah.
Yes.
Shiva, because if you do this distal plate first technique, I think this this is the impaction, the disimpaction of the fragment. Distal plate first technique, which is done over here by Dr. Chanda. If at all there is a split in the lunate fragment, palmar and dorsal fragments, do you reduce the split, put your distal screws past your split into the dorsal fragment also, and then get the plate back onto the proximal fragment?
It's difficult, because many a time we pass only the plate, only one screw partly into the distal fragment, not across to the split. Then we compress from the dorsum, hold it with a clamp, then we further advance.
You're doing the distal fragment first, you need to reduce your distal fragments properly, your lunate. Correct.
Yes.
And then you can do it. But then generally we can easily do it with the other way around also, the normal way, without doing this distal fragment first technique.
You know, we'll finish this presentation. If there is anything, we'll see.
Shiva sir, Anil sir wants to say something. Shiva sir,
yes.
He wants to say something.
Yes.
Yeah, Anil sir wants to
say something. As Dr. Amit was telling, when you have these two big fragments, and again, it's your axial view tells you which is the bigger fragment, whether it's the dorsal side or is the ulnar side. Yeah. And the smart way is to use that larger fragment to lift off things. So either you go dorsally or ulnarly, so that you try to not, you know, if it's 50-50, then that's a different thing. But a lot of times it is just the one major fragment will be either dorsal or ulnar. And there's a danger that you would increase that anteroposterior kind of diameter when you're trying to do. So the point that you made where you have to fix both together and then do the liftoff is actually valid. Otherwise, you either end up having this kind of a deformity or you'll have this kind of a deformity.
An intra-articular deformity.
Yes. And that gap will be created. So to be very careful how you choose to lift it off. It's not a straightforward technique in that sense.
We'll go through the large fragment approach.
Yes.
There is an interesting case sent by one of the Dr. Sanjay Sarvaya from Bhavnagar in Gujarat. Laborer, 35 years, machine injury, compound wound over the palmar aspect, fracture lower third ulna with fracture radius, bone loss, that is huge defect in the radius, cut flexor tendons, nerves and vessels intact. Distal neurovascular, normal. Yes, Bharat, how do you proceed? Because you are a pure hand surgeon, because we have general orthopedic surgeon, Asim and Amin. So I'll ask you this question first.
Absolutely. So now you said where was the wound? Wound is on the radial side.
Yes.
And it's a compound fracture.
Yeah.
So if the patient comes within acute within 2 to 6 hours, so definitely I would put him for debridement. I would plate the ulna only and then X-fix on the radial side and then wait for some time till the once you control the soft tissue cover, repair the flexor tendons and get a good soft tissue cover. Once you get the soft tissue cover free from the infection and then take out the X-fix on the radial side and then do a bone grafting.
Yes, fine. Yes, perfectly. Then Asim, you want to add anything?
No, sir. Expert no. Point. Yeah, there is very little to add.
Yes. Okay. Amit wanted to say, no, you have to unmute. Amit, you have to unmute. Yes.
I think I would try a masculine over here because the antibiotic cement would clear the infection also, if at all, if there is any prediction of it.
That sounds a good option. Yes. Okay. As Bharat said, the same way he has treated. Instead of extrafixator, yes, put a K-wire between the distal fragment and ulna. Then he was treated with a fiber above elbow slab. Then at 4 weeks, you can see that the wounds all healed and the patient was mobilized. Now what? Yes, Asim, what you'll do? Fibular grafting or bone grafting?
Fibula plus autogenous cancerous bone graft and a plate.
Yes. Okay. I think that's a. So this was treated with free fibula harvested and fixed snugly into the gap plus iliac crest bone grafting additionally. Long joint spanning, small DCP. Again, you can see that it is to the base of the second metacarpal. It has been put in this case. This is 9 months follow up. You can see the nice restoration. And this is 2 years follow up. You can see that. Fibula is incorporated very well. And this is the good function, flexion and extension. Yes.
Rather than a bridging plate, probably I would use the plate on the volar surface. There is enough distal fragment there and maybe 3 or 4 weeks of X-fix if at all it was needed to support that.
Okay.
Plate all through.
This is a distraction plate. Generally, if you use
it wasn't required. Actually. He had a nice good positional.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. That's true.
Yes, but, yes, Anil sir.
So my only concern was you said the plate was there for 6 months or 9 months.
Yeah.
So that's a very long duration, and I'm not sure about the wrist movement, the photo shown, but I think 9 months is a really long time for that distraction plate to be sitting inside.
Yes. But anyway, our final outcome seems good. Yeah. And we started with a very bad case to begin with.
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, it's a very nice outcome.
Correct. Bharat, you will present your case. Yes. You have to unmute. Bharat. Yes. Bharat,
I think you can one second. So I need just a minute to get the PowerPoint on. In the meantime,
no, I have presented. You can use this. If you want, you can share your screen. No problem.
No, you put it on the screen, sir. Okay.
Yeah, I already done.
I'm not able to see.
Not see.
Okay, then I'll reshare this. Now you can see.
Yes. Now I can see. Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. 25-year-old, fallen outstretched hand. And no other injuries. Anybody would like to take a guess? What you would like to do?
Asim.
Traction
X-ray.
Okay.
Anil sir, you can unmute and you can keep speaking in between.
Yeah.
Because nowadays it is only discussion. We can all of us can keep speaking. Yeah.
It's a closed injury, Bharat?
Yes, closed injury, absolutely.
Closed injury, okay. Any further imaging you have?
CT or?
Yeah.
Next slide, sir.
Do you have do you have a CT?
Yes, that's the one.
There it is.
Okay. So again, it is almost equal dorsal and volar fragments there, and with a major radial column is also involved. And there is a depression there on the junction of the scaphoid and the lunate facet. Both are depressed, which means basically there is an intra-articular free fragment inside. But reasonably well-aligned sigmoid notch for the ulnar head. So that should be okay. So
another concern, Anil, how do you do grade this AO classification on X-ray or CT? Because X-ray it is C1 and CT it is C3. You can see the combination.
Yeah.
X-ray just looks like a simple intra-articular fracture. Whereas, you know,
I mean,
see
the here CT. I would go for the fragment specific kind of a classification here. That's why I said you need to combine those things.
Yes.
So you need to see where those all those major fragments are, what is happening. So my concern would be here, of course, the radial column looks, if you see this axial view here, the third one, the radial column will be almost like, you know, very powdery kind of thing. And there will be that intra-articular fragment, which will be free. And you need to get those two together. That is that will be my concern. And you have the dorsal fragment, which is, I think, in this situation can be caught hold by the ulnar site, if at all you're going for a plate fixation.
And in addition, he also has a ulnar styloid fracture.
A styloid fracture, yes.
Yes, excellent. Amit, you have to unmute. Yes, keep it unmuted only. Yes.
Is at the base, the ulnar styloid fracture. So generally, if you get a very good reduction of your distal radius, and in this case, it is expected that you get a very good reduction. And once you get a reduction, I think that ulnar styloid fracture may not require, if it is not displaced, of any fixation. Yeah.
Yeah. It is a base fracture, but it's not displaced also. Yeah. But at the end of the day, it's purely a clinical examination for the instability.
Right.
Yes. That is the most important. Yes. But even again, sorry.
The plan was to fix the plate and then look for the DRH instability.
Yeah.
And I feel compared to in the different positions of the pronation, mid-prone and the supination. So I felt it good to fix a KVAR in the 1.2 mm KVAR in the ulnar styloid also.
Yeah. Beautifully.
I usually use a variable angle plate in this kind of fracture.
I just want to make one point with the ulnar styloid fixations. Always open it. It should not be percutaneous. Yes. It's an avulsion fracture. If at all there is a good fracture, so always make a mini small opening here and then visualize and put the fragment back if you are pinning it.
Always be aware
of the dorsal sensory branch of the ulnar nerve during
that procedure. Many times you're
trying to push it, it's not going to reduce.
The CM can be misleading and may not be able to go through the fragment because it's a small one. Yes.
Correct. Yes, next case.
So, yeah. 45-year-old beautician who had fallen the outstretched hand, presented, you know, 2 days after the injury.
Yeah. Amit, yes.
Dominant hand.
The teardrop is very clearly seen over here, as well as the radial styloid. It's more of a ulnar injury. So I think in these cases, I would first take a traction view. Do you all take traction views? Because just you need to see the anatomy properly. And far distal fragments, maybe it will require a molar rim plate.
Amit, basically, traction view is not routinely done. So we do a close reduction, get the CT. But intraoperative, when you start the surgery, that is the time I would like to do the traction and screening. That gives me a lot of information as to what is happening dynamically.
Do you agree that the carpus has just started shifting ularly?
Yeah. You have a different fragment, you have a teardrop. So you have to concentrate more on the volar fragment, a teardrop fragment.
And also there's intra-articular depression.
Depression, yes.
Yeah, depression also. Also the radial styloid is also not looking that good. It is also split probably.
You need to
release the brachioradialis to release the tension on the radial styloid.
Absolutely.
And maybe a screw which is directed towards the radial styloid and as well as a buttress of the volar teardrop.
Right.
Is it possible to catch hold with a radial pin here? Because it is so badly comminuted, radial side, you see.
Shiva, I always, whenever I am operating, I always my first implant inside is a K wire. Though I'm planning plating, a volar plating or a dorsal plating, a K wire going from the radial styloid into the proximal fragment. That is my first implant. After that, I after giving fraction, reducing.
Okay. Shall I proceed, Bharat?
Yes, sir. Please. Will you
buttress this radial styloid? It's very comminuted.
Yes. Because my plan based on the CT was actually to use a variable angle plate, the volar locking variable angle plate, because I'm happy with the column by column fixation, you can catch in most of the fragments. Only if those fragments which are unstable, then I tend to put in a wire. But if the variable angle plate can hold most of the fragments, I don't do that.
Okay. Bharat, you are not using the tunique what Dr. Anil was telling. That's a new point for even for me today. I learned something for the wrist arthroscopy. Yes. Yeah.
Yes, right. Yeah, so I did the arthroscopy just to look at the fragments step and then put in two wires.
If you are doing anyway dry arthroscopy, then you don't require this tunique, isn't it, Anil sir?
Yes. Yeah,
definitely, sir.
Absolutely. Yes.
But in for the initial flushing out, again, it might still be worthwhile, because sometimes we see that the patient has come 2 days later and all to clear that hematoma is a difficult task. So keep putting a lot of cell line, and that might still extravasate.
A good suggestion to apply the tunicate and do not inflate it initially. Do your dry scopy and then
he
applies
over
the
S mark and then so that your hematoma,
so that seepage will not happen, or it will happen minimally. This is the anything, Amit, comment.
Now, the volar teardrop fragment there, that teardrop, probably that one screw is there into the teardrop, that screw could have been slightly divergent and engaging more of the teardrop into the dorsal fragment also. Anyway, it is a very well done. Looking at this X-ray, I would like to ask you one more thing. Is in the proximal fragment, do you need these three screws, or is a single screw enough, single good holding screw in the proximal fragment?
A single locking and two cortical screws should be good enough,
Three are a bit more, okay. Yeah. This is very well done.
So, can I ask one question?
Yes, Asim.
Suppose this fragment you want to cheat a bit and the plate is not variable angle. So how does it affect the holding power of the screw if you intentionally angle it 10 degree, 12 degree here or there? Just to cheat and ask you at the right place. Any opinions?
I think, what I do is, if it is not engaging, I do not change the direction of the locking screw, but I make a small incision, or my incision goes on that and add another separate screw, a screw separate from the plate, so that you get a good reduction of your teardrop.
Yeah. Okay. Then what he wanted to know is
I want to ask
slightly angle. Yes.
Is whether non-variable angle plate, if you cheat by 10 degree, does it really a young person?
So the head will not, head of the screw will not get locked properly.
It won't lock, sir.
It won't lock properly. And then you will have to change the position of the plate, and then you might have problems there.
Yes. Yeah,
might have to cross the.
I think in the last case from Bharat. Yeah. Yes, Bharat.
Yes, sir. 35-year-old, again fallen the outstretched
hand. Polar bald.
Yes. This is a shift to the carpus, and there was a. This guy works in Singapore, one of the NGO companies there. So all the way he flew down, and then we could see the volar fragment, and the volar carpal ligaments were attached to the volar fragment. So it was more like a rim fracture too.
Can you show the pre-op? Go back one. Yeah, okay. This is quite a large volar fragment.
Volar fragment, yes.
There is total subluxation of the wrist.
Total subluxation of the carpus, fragment. Yes. Then just retaining the soft tissue attachment of the volar fragment, I had to use the rim plate.
But instead of a normal plate, wouldn't have sufficed over here?
No.
Plate. There's quite a small fragment intraoperatively. So it was quite difficult to get that fragment. So then I shifted over to the rim plate.
Yeah.
And that's the scar function of at the end of 6 months.
I wanted to ask you, Dr. Bharat. The rim plate, many a times it does not fit over there, especially those two flanges.
So try using the left side one on the right side.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Actually, the side which is more powerful, which is operated by you.
Yes. Trained, exactly. So he came back after another year and then got the plate removed. Rim plates, particularly because they cross the watershed line, we may have a tendency to remove them. Yeah.
So, next case.
This is a 40-year-old guy who was just crossing the road on the Mysore road, Bangalore Mysore road. And then when he was just crossing to buy some eatables and then getting back to his car, there's a huge truck which hit him, fell down on both the hands and injured. Almost done 8 years back. So this is the only X-ray available. Bilateral hand injury.
Okay. This is right side. You added any bone graft, I think?
Yes, for the radius, I had a bone graft, yes.
Okay.
And left side, because it is a dorsal comminuted fragment with the dorsal subluxation, I used the dorsal plate to buttress the fragment.
Okay. You should purchase one more instrument so that you can take simultaneously the X-ray.
Yes, yes.
So,
this is the last patient, I think. This was a compound RTA, young fellow, 20-year-old guy with a road traffic accident. It is a type 3A compound where the dorsal wound was on the dorsal aspect, dorsal ulnar aspect, where the distal ulna was projecting out of the wound with minimal contamination. And you can see the previous slide. Yes. How do you manage this? There's a wound on the dorsal ulnar aspect of the wrist where the distal ulna was projecting out of the wound. And in addition to that, you can see a fracture dislocation.
Asim.
Reduce, get a CT scan, then debride, maybe a rim plate for the lower end radius, and still you will require either external fixator as a neutralization to hold the wrist till the soft tissues heal, because there is a lot of subluxation there and translation. So it's a real bad injury.
Yeah. In an acute setting like
that. Debridement.
Yes.
Neil Neuro.
Dorsally, you said the ulna head was out.
Yes, out of the skin. Yeah.
Contaminated,
yes. Yes.
You'll require multiple surgeries then.
Yes. So since he had come well in time, I took the courage to debride it well, plate the radius at the same time because ulnar aspect there was no wound. And then I transfixed the DROJ because in a disruption like this, invariably the TFCC is gone. The triangular fibrocartilage complex along with the ulnar and dorsal component is gone. So I did a polar approach to the radius, plated it, and then transfixed this one. It eventually healed well. There was no infection.
Professor, it looks like a very old patient because the plate also is...
Yes, old one. Yes. Almost this was
and it's going far down below there.
5-6 years back, yes.
Yeah, much
older. You have one more.
There's one. This is just for... No? Discussion. What next? Yeah. Interesting patient. So this patient was operated elsewhere. 3 months of a 65-year-old gentleman with a distal radius fracture presented 3 months after the fixation. This can happen with plating, you know. Not all plates can go smooth. You can see this plate is out of place. He's already developed the complex regional syndrome, pain syndrome, and then the stiffness of the fingers. Not to make
this a I'll give it to expert Anil Bhatt, sir.
Was it a open injury to start with?
No, it is just a comminuted distal radius fractures.
So I would get the present no evidence of infection clinically, ESR, CRP.
No evidence of infection, yeah. But he's not able to make a fist, his fingers are stiff.
Yeah, because I see that resorption of the bone there in the distal aspect here. Yes. I would be very wary about any low-grade infection which is happening there. ESR, CRP counts, everything
normal. Normal, everything is normal.
Okay. So, and movements, range of motion?
Nothing. Yeah, just a jog of moments. It's completely stiff. Yes. Next slide, sir. There also we have the ulnar aspect you can see. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, the CRPS and surgery, they can go hand in hand. I mean, you don't have to wait for CRPS to settle and they know that is an old concept. So
exactly.
You actually treat the patient for you to get rid of CRP. That is very important. So a lot of surgeons tell, let the CRP settle and then we'll go and do something about it. That is not, actually patient has to move. Otherwise, the surgery will never go. So we need to check the MCP range of motion the MCPs will start mobilizing them as soon as possible.
Absolutely.
And then you need to think what you need to do with that risk. If you look at that articular surface, there is hardly any.
Nothing there, yes, left. So I just went ahead and fused the wrist with the dorsal plate and started moving the fingers, and then he got back his function. Good, yeah. Because there was no way of salvaging the wrist. Just out of interest, I had put up this.
Did you do? I mean, a lot of times in these situations, when the DRVG is also disrupted, you combine a Kapanji with the fusion. With the fusion, so that patients do get good range of motion for pronation, supination also.
Absolutely. So
that's an option you can do.
Shiva, can I share?
Yeah, you can. You can share. Not a problem. I'll stop.
Because this is something else, yeah, Shiva, you might not be having that reason. Yeah. This is the... I generally take these traction views.
Yeah. But don't give the copy to the patient. Otherwise, it looks totally
It runs away. Looks normal if at all. Most of these comminuted bad-looking fractures get reduced. And this, now look over here, the dorsal tilt is still there. So it's an unstable injury.
So Amit, can you go back? That one previous. No, the next one. Next one. Yes. So if you see that just below the articular surface, if you see those kind of, you know, fluffy kind of thing, Dr. Sudhir Varias always teaches me that he calls it clouds. So if you see that, definitely means there's a very bad combination and it won't stay there. Yeah, that is very, very important. Yeah, that is a very unstable situation.
Yeah, that is true. Absolutely right.
Yeah.
And that is basically it's a flake of these dorsal and molar fragments.
Correct.
Yeah. What would you do, Anil? Yeah, Dr. Anil.
Yeah. I mean, it is those, again, the same free intra-articular fragments floating there. And then now.
Intra-articular fracture, yeah, correct.
Yes. Plus, the sigmoid notch again is not congruent there.
Dorsal combination, yeah.
And the dorsal. I would still go volarly for this patient. The dorsal, there's a big. Nice buttress of volar that cortex still remaining,
yeah.
And I would like to use that for my plate actually. Yes,
so this is not a very this is quite a distal fragment, volarly, quite
yes.
A fragment. So, you know, which plate would you use volarly?
I mean, I would still go for a rim, because if you see that the radial column is definitely gone there, and I would require some variable angle there to catch those fragments. And this dorsal fragment there is just a flake of bone there, right?
Yes.
And so take advantage of the volar fragment, the buttress there, and get in the plate there as distally as possible, and try to catch that dorsal fragment through that with your fragment, the screws going a little more proximally.
Yeah. Negi, sir?
Use a volar plate. Maybe if I'm in a soup, then I'll make a small dorsal incision and reduce the fracture and then put my screws volarward.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you incise it dorsally, why not put a dorsal plate?
That will be decided on table. Everything is available.
Absolutely. I opened it volarly first, but
yeah,
I was not getting a good reduction on the dorsal side. So I went and put this dorsal plate and it buttressed it so beautifully. So I got this reduction first. Then I had this fragment over here, the radial styloid, which was a very large piece of bone. And I thought I should go volarly also. So I went volarly. I'll show you. This you have already showed, because there's generally a split over here because lack of ligaments on the volar as well as the dorsal side on this sick.
Yeah.
I'll go ahead. The final x-ray.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's reduced nicely. Yes.
Good.
And
good.
The thing about this is, this patient, I generally don't like these dorsal plates over there for quite a long time. So this patient, I went down after 2 months and removed both the plates. I had planned only a dorsal plate excision, but saw that the fracture had united. So went down and removed even the volar plate. And this is the follow-up x-ray, and this is 5 months down the line, and this is the patient 5 months down the line.
Sir.
So you removed both the plates at 2 months.
Both the plates at 2 months.
Earlier.
Okay.
I know. I do understand.
I wouldn't be so brave like you.
Yeah. I do understand. But then I gave it a chance. I thought dorsal plate removal, the fracture had united. Why not give the patient an advantage of this surgery?
You put her on a cast or a splint post removal?
Just an elastic bandage was there. So this is she.
Thank you.
Yeah. Great results.
This X-ray was not showing. It was showing union. This is at the time when I removed. There was a small fracture line still over there. But then I was quite confident that it had united. So I went ahead and this was the final year. Another case here. Look at this. What would you opt for over here? I'll show you. Look, I went ahead and this was opened volarly again. And here the dorsal fragment was not allowing it. It was quite a comminuted fracture over there. So I put a dorsal plate first. Once you put that dorsal buttress, one screw, you get a very good tilt of that distal fragment. And then I went ahead and put this dorsal volar plate. And this was it. But look at this screw. You can see the screw. This screw is quite a little bit long, only 2 threads. But then since the dorsal side was opened, I went dorsally and saw the screw. It was quite a big thing. Even if 2 threads are out, you know, you should remember always that this screw has to be short. It cannot be long. It cannot be proud because it will irritate the tendons, extensor tendons dorsally. So there I went and changed the screw and this was the changed screw. So this was the final X-ray.
And Amit, would you try to remove the dorsal plate then and check actually?
I had told this patient, but this patient I had operated during the lockdown, the early phase. She has not come for follow-up. This is the last
No. What I'm asking is intra-op. You said, see, when you just put in one single screw and buttress it, you get this nice reduction. And then you put in the volar plate, right?
Yeah,
and then you see whether you can take off that plate at that time and this whole volar plate actually holds on to it nicely.
I never gave it a thought and I didn't do that because I thought it was
next time. Holding. Next time, yes, that's a good idea. Once it is well buttressed and holding.
Probably, maybe, yeah, correct. Yeah, yeah. Now look at this. No, this as I told you. Many a times I go more on the doing this modified Henry's approach, and after plating it. I open a slight another window through the muscles and the digitorum tendons over here, and the medial nerve comes over here, and then here I clearly see this part, the DRUJ, and if at all required, I can put another screw through this incision. One screw with a washer can hold as a one hole plate, can act as a one hole plate. So you know, many a times I've done this. And I can put another screw. This screw was put through the plate itself because it was a bit difficult from here approaching this area. And look, this is a slightly divergent screw which was going inside the the teardrop fragment, and it was holding the dorsal fragment. Also, you can see over here. Yeah. This is another case, an 85-year-old gentleman, but he was very active and a very high demanding patient, an 85-year-old. So I thought, why not? So in this case, probably you will be of an opinion of to do a conservative management. Did a CT scan. The CT scan is overlapping. But this is the CT scan. I went ahead and there was a large, as you see over here, the palmar fragments, the dorsal fragment, and the radial styloid. We went ahead, we put this. There was a big teardrop which needed a buttress. The teardrop buttressing was done. But somehow, this screw of this radial styloid screw was not going till the radial styloid tip. I wasn't happy. So I just put this screw and then added another plate for the radial styloid. Through the same incision, I could do this radial styloid lateral plating. And this is the lateral plate, which I did. And then this is the follow-up of that patient. This is around 5 months post-op. This was operated during the lockdown phase. And here, this is the supination, and he had a good pronation also. I think these images are overlapping, so he did well.
Yeah, I mean that CT straight away no conservative.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah,
I'll stop sharing. You can go ahead because lack of time.
You want to share, or shall I project your case?
No, I will try, sir. Give me 1 minute. Yeah.
Okay. then you can keep them ready. I have got a small
it presentation. It is ready.
Okay. No, I have done already my presentation sharing. This is a very old, 2002. Bharat, this patient, young adult, is a second or third year engineering student who came to me. This is at 4 months. This is between 3 to 4 months trauma. He is very, very unhappy with the treatment he has received. What to
Absolutely. Do? I will do a dorsal open with osteotomy, put in a bone graft and put a plate.
Okay. Anybody else different?
Lengthening osteotomy of the radius I will do.
Okay. Yeah. Anil sir?
I go OLR most of the times for corrective osteotomies.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, this case...
CT will definitely help us to get a better personality of the...
our understanding of the DR, UGR and distal radius with CT was all very less at that time. Yes, yes, Asim.
Bharat sir and Anil sir, you do your osteotomies through the volar approach, but do you graft it or it just a volar plate which keeps the whole correction and there is a void there?
As I said, personally for me, off late we have not been using graft at all with the locking plates.
So it's only volar osteotomy.
Yes. And we have seen, we have analyzed our series of patients. We have seen that they heal. Some couple of patients might take some longer time, but most of them heal without a graft. Yes. And there are enough literature nowadays. There are enough studies which also shows with and without graft and both of them are doing well. If the patient is a smoker or if the gap is too much, maybe yes. But otherwise, generally, they heal well.
If it's only... angulation, I will accept, but here there is
shortening. Shortening is there. 5 to 6 millimeters of shortening is a concern.
No, he's just a college student. Yes. Yeah. Amit, this is, I'm talking about 2002. So you have to unmute and speak. What you are going to do? When we were not having even volar plates, we were having just a few dorsal plates and T plates we were using then.
If you're just talking about the shortening, I would do a Kapanji procedure over here. Because... okay. And if you are accepting the low wall, the dorsal tilt. But if I'm doing some procedure, I would also correct the dorsal tilt, which is not very acceptable over here. I would, at 3 months, I feel you can go down in the fracture site itself. And in the fracture direction, you can just tilt it back to its position. You can easily get a neutral tilt over here, which is very well accepted. And then...
We did a dorsal open wedge osteotomy, hammer a tricortical graft and fix it with K-wires and a patta for about 6 weeks.
Sir, if you are doing a Kapanji procedure, a tricortical graft won't be required. Probably for
Kapanji long term is not good. This can become normal.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. That's not a preferred treatment. With a escalop clamp, there is a threaded rod. 6 millimeter threaded rod over that 8 millimeter tubes go. I distracted using that escalop clamp, and this is the final result I got him in this patient. This is after external big center. Tilt also could be reasonably corrected, though I not aimed in. I was only aiming to get back the DRUJ in position because our understanding of the distal radius. All this fracture was also very, very minimum at that time. And this is the left hand, actually. Clinically, you don't see that he has got any deformity. He has become a software engineer now. This Excellent. Is another case, again, 2009, with a volar displaced fragment. Here, as you said, I had gone through volar aspect, done a osteotomy, then put a tricortical graft from the iliac crest and fix that with a volar plate, which was available by then already locking plates. This is follow-up picture. You can see the distal radiolar joint at the tilt. Everything has been maintained quite well. And the patient had a excellent result. And this is at the time of removal of the implant. And I couldn't get the after removal x-ray. So implants were removed and this is the picture. In the same lady after the implants have been removed. So this is a excellent outcome. This is recently I've treated this patient in 2018. This patient, though 41 years, they were not ready for any surgery. They wanted just improvement in the function. How to treat this? Amit? 41-year lady with, again, conservatively treated with a plaster cast. No reduction has been done. Just a plaster has been applied.
Was there any problem? Was she having any problem over here?
Because she had a deformity which they wanted better function. She had pain.
Then that pain is because of the ulna.
Ulna head was very, very prominent. And actually the pain was over the tip of the ulnar sternal process. In this area, she was getting all the pain.
Yeah, then you have to do a Kapanji over here. You have to.
Yes, Anil Bhatt, sir.
So for me, Kapanji is basically for arthritis. So if DRUJ is arthritic, I would go for a Kapanji. Otherwise, I would always try to restore the normal anatomy. Either do a osteotomy of the radius and correct the angulation, and it, or if it all it is like there is too much of shortening, as you showed the earlier case, I would go for an ulnar shortening. One of the things, but then basically try to get the DRUJ back. And you have done an ulnar shortening. That's what I see. So the DRUJ is to come back there. Kapanji is reserved only if there is an arthritis of the distal radial ulna joint. So either you lengthen and get the radial height back and inclination, or you shorten the ulna. Shortening the ulna is always a little more challenging and a little more, can be more complicated than doing a radial osteotomy. So that is the usual experience.
Yeah. I discuss all the options with them, lengthening the radius, then shortening the ulna, all those things. And finally, they decided to get the ulna shortening because that seemed to be the simplest thing for them. And she really is, had an excellent outcome.
Only thing is, she has this
dorsal subluxation.
Eventually, she accepted it. Yeah.
Yes.
So the latest, can I, sir?
Yeah, definitely.
So actually, the latest approach would be for this to do a 3D CT and get a 3D printing model. And you measure your the 41-year-old, not all that aged, to reconstruct the distal radius. Ideally, it would be a 3D CT and a 3D printing model, and then calculate your osteotomy angles, correct it, and then get your spine. But of course, depending on how the patient.
Discussing about the patient, do take part in the treatment, because financial aspect, social aspect is one other thing where that also decides about. Yes, Asim, you can share your
screen. Yes, sir.
Asim has a beautiful X-ray. That's why I wanted him to present last.
Sir, I share first and then.
Yeah. You share first. Click on share, then open.
Okay.
You open the presentation first.
Yeah.
Then you click on share button.
Okay. Just a minute. Yeah.
Okay. Otherwise, all your three presentations are ready with me. Yeah, I can open up. Yeah.
Can you see it now?
No.
Okay. Zoom meeting.
Okay, I will share it. Don't worry.
Just a minute. Yeah.
Okay.
You want okay, to you share it now. Yeah.
Yes. This is the first case. 49-year heavy manual worker, dominant hand, 4 months post injury.
Shiva, make it full screen. It's not full screen.
It's full screen already.
It's okay, full screen,
okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Your internet is slow.
Yes.
Okay, you can
49-year-old male. Actually, he's a Luhar. Does a real heavy manual work. Dominant hand. One of my colleagues treated him for 4 months with close reduction and K-wiring. Obviously, the patient wasn't having those X-rays. They were sort of hidden. And the treating surgeon himself sent the patient to me. Next. This is how it looked. Can we go back to the X-ray? And obviously very financially constrained also.
Any median nerve symptoms, sir?
Not really. But he was crippled. He was out of job for almost 6 months now by the time he came to me.
Okay.
And probably it wasn't united also.
Yes, definitely.
Yes. Rarely it goes into nothing. So I decided to reconstruct it. Next. Shiva, sir, next.
Yeah.
Next. I took a volar approach, exposed the volar surface, removed all the slow. Removed all the fibrous tissue. Volar capsule is to be preserved. Next, dorsal approach. Shwasan, next.
Yeah. I've done.
Expose your process surface completely
yes.
and mobilized it all around, release the brachioradialis. Next. Then I exposed the ulnar non-union, which was a hypertrophic non-union, removed all that callus, freshened the ends, and reduced the ulna. Then I put a clamp on the ulna and passed those Indian locking plates. They have got K-wire holes to position the plate so that your plate is not flying off at one corner. Next, yeah. This is where initially I started on the left picture, and on the right picture is how it's sort of aligned now. So this gives idea of how much ulna shortening is required to equalize the radio ulnar length. That much ulna was shortened approximately. Next. The ulnar plating was completed. This is the temporary reduction for the K-wire, for the lower end of the radius. The volar inclination, length, and volar tilt is neutral so far, but there is a decent position of the lower end radius. Next. The volar plate was applied. A lift technique was used. The distal metafacial screws were passed first. The plate is off the shaft of the radius proximally. And once we tighten those screws, next. Stress and next, yeah. We could restore the volar tilt nicely. Because it was an Indian plate, which is not as strong as the imported volar plates, I added a dorsal plate also for added stability plus better fixation. Next. This is how he was immediately post-op. Next. This is 9 months. And next. That's his function. He's absolutely normal back to his job, which is pretty heavy job.
So you recreated the fracture and then
yeah. The bone grafting plate. Fracture was not united, sir. It was fibrous. Yes. It wasn't united. And all the ulna callus and the shortening bone I used as bone graft. No Lycris bone graft was used.
Absolutely. Nice result.
Yes, sir. Shwa,
There
is a volar. Yeah. This was a young male with this type of wrist fracture, and he had a real bad bicondylar tibia also involving all four columns. So that is a separate story. For this, SCT was done. Next. But sir, what will you do? There are more images of the CT there, probably one or two. Yeah. This is a complete picture. This is how it is.
Yeah. Initially, I would go volar to keep the option of the variable variable angle plate with the double column fixation. Look at the reduction. If I'm happy with the reduction, getting the screws to get the fragments in place, then if you're still not happy with the fragment which is not holding, then may add another plate.
And that's
the reduced alert plate.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. That's exactly what we did. These are the intraop spin. Volar lunate fragment was reduced proximally and fixed with a K wire from radius to ulnar side like this. Next. Then brachioradialis was released. A sharp spike was used to reduce cystoid fragments, and we fixed it with a K wire. While passing this K wire, lunate fossa fragment got displaced. So we lost the reduction. So undid everything and started again. Next. This is the perfect reduction, which is held temporarily by three K wires. The volar lunate fragment was very small. There was another crack. The metafacial beak looks pretty long, but there was another fracture just below the articular surface. So I used the rim plate. And next. That's how it went. The first screw pass was in the lunate fossa there. Second was the solid fragment screw. Next. As we tightened the oblong screw, the plate was flush and the volar tilt was nicely restored. Next. Still the radial solid fragment purchase, as Dr. Bharat rightly pointed out, was very poor. So I had a radial solid plate and pressed it nicely. Next. Next. More. Next. Yeah, that's 7 weeks. Next. That's 14 weeks. One more should be there. That's 28 months. And now is almost 4 years. I told this patient around 6 months that 1 year will take out the plate. But he simply refuses that there is no problem. So I really don't know what to do.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, sir.
After passing, or the there were KYS even through the radial standard. If you have put the radial standard plate, why did you keep the KYS there?
Probably they were not required. Agreed.
Yeah.
But sometimes if there are too many pieces, surgeon is afraid he wants to keep it for 2-3 weeks, 4 weeks.
Probably. Oh, apprehension actually. But then it was an excellent, very well done case. Very nice.
Yeah.
Probably one more case. Is there, Shiv. Yeah. Last
yeah,
one.
Last yeah, case.
We can skip some slides. He has already talked about 3-4 slides we can skip. Move on. Sir has taught all this. Yeah. Next. Yeah, here. Shiva, can we go back one? Yeah. We treated a lot of these malunions. So if the malunion is only about 8 weeks, I think is the limit. 8, maybe 10 weeks. When you can really pry open the fracture by removing the callus and you can easily go through the same fracture plane and reduce it and buttress it, as we did in these patients. But if it's more than 3 months, then definitely you can't open up the fracture. You have to do a osteotomy, as we did for this patient on the right side, lower down there. Next. This patient was twice treated outside, like this, and we did an osteotomy and used a buttress plate. And finally, next, patient had an excellent result. The present problem is a young patient, 5 months old fracture, twice K-wiring was done outside. And this is how he came after 5 months. Very young chap and dominant hand. Anil sir?
Yeah. This is 5 months old now, twice K-wiring. Yeah.
Dominant hand.
Yeah. And it's a combination of both extra and intra-articular malunion here.
Yeah.
That's what is there with the subluxated carpus. So going through the old footprint of the fracture itself can be sometimes difficult. And one of the options you can do if the articular surface is intact is to go through a fresh site of osteotomy. That is one way of doing it. Otherwise, you will have to combine this extra-articular with the intra-articular osteotomy and try to lift it. You'll invariably end up with a gap, and you need to be ready to fill that subchondral area with the graft. That is one way of doing it. So a lot of times I don't go through the old fracture site if it is involving the articular surface. And if the articular surface is intact there, then lift the entire thing from a new area. That is one way of approaching that. But otherwise here, I think that technique can't be used. You need to deal with it specifically to get that ulnar lunate fragment up. Through a combined extra and intra-articular kind of a osteotomy.
Shiva sir, can we move forward? Yeah. So what are the problems? These are the problems. It requires extremely precise planning, which is very difficult to actually execute on table. You can splinter the osteotomized fragment because it's very porotic and thin. The whole fragment can become osteonecrotic. You will have to enter the joint. So there is a risk of stiffness. And finally, a reconstructive surgery can go into a non-union. And if you cannot restore the DRVJ, you will have rotational deficits. Next. We chose an FCR approach. We released the brachioral disc. My threshold for releasing the brachioral disc is very, very low, even in fresh cases, as Dr. Anil rightly pointed out. Any fracture more than 8 to 10 days, if you release the brachioral disc completely, life becomes much easier. At 5 months, osteotomy was planned in the plane of original fracture. You had to go to the console, see all the images and mentally visualize the original plane of the fracture and try to mimic that on table as close as possible. It will not be precise, but as close as possible. Next. The multiple K-wire, 1.5 mm K-wires were used to make drill holes in the planned area of osteotomy, and then a thin flexible 5 mm osteotom was used. Next, this is how we did the osteotomy. Use a very thin flexible osteotome. At 5 months, normally we just give traction and hyperextend the wrist and the carpus reduces, but at 5 months it will not be possible. Use a blunt, thin but a strong dura retractor and do a maneuver like this. You can really do this in about say 5 to 8 minutes, 10 minutes, but slowly the soft tissues will stretch without damaging the carpal bones. You will be able to put back the carpus in its original position. The triangular area is showing the amount of void which will be there. That gives you some idea of the size of the tricortical graft you will require there. Next, to maintain the concavity of the articular surface, you don't want this to be not like a saucer. You want that normal shape to be restored. So you have to maintain this concavity. The bone graft side size is measured, and that measured tricortical graft will be hammered there. Next. Shivasan, next. Then transfix it with K wire, and you can bring out this K wire on the dorsal surface so that only tip is seen there, so it doesn't hamper with your plate positioning. Next. Next. Shivasan, next. Yeah. Cancellous chip was packed in the voids. Next. Next. Agla, yeah. Next.
1 year post-operative.
One more is there, yeah. 4 years, yeah. Next.
Post-operative.
Ek aur hoga function ka. That is how he is. He goes to gym. He plays tennis. Is absolutely normal.
Yes. I think we can stop.
Literature shows that it's a beautiful operation. The results are brilliant.
I think restoring the anatomy, I think, yeah, is a take-home message. You know, restoring, yes, the anatomy, sir, is very crucial to get back the function, particularly in young individuals. Yes. As much as possible, we should try and restore the.
Yeah, very, very grateful.
Very good outcome. Thank you.
Yes, that was excellent case. Even I am seeing a intra-articular osteotomy for a distal radius for the first time.
Shivasar, okay. We got a fairly large number for a private practitioner. Yes. Me and my friend must have got about 25, almost more than
that. Thank your friends you should thank.
And we should thank other people who send at 2 months and 3 months, all subluxated carpus.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Before and not many people are doing it, so we grab them.
Yes.
Do it free.
Okay. Okay. Any last sentence, Bharat? Then I mean, yes.
Yes. Yeah, thank you for being, you know, making us, including us to be a part of this wonderful webinar on distal fracture, Shivshankar sir. And I wish you all the best in the future. We have a lot more to come, so academic and then so much interest in research and academics. Thank you so much. And I thank Anil for the exemplary exposition on the distal fractures. Yes. And the most important, his take home message, I would like to reinforce that. The method of plaster application. Many of these patients we see treated conservatively for distal radius fractures, they can't even able to make a fist. They have the stiffness, and we often blame it on the patient telling it's a CRPS. And if you ask the patient why you are stiff, why is your hand stiff, why you are not able to use your hand, they say, I was never told to move my fingers. So simple six-pack exercise when the patient is on a plaster, the keeping simple points
even
like, you know,
keep plaster. No, even if you tell, they don't listen. Today only I saw one patient, I had done tibia nailing 2 months back. Yes. He came for follow-up and he's asking me today, shall I have bath? Yes. So in spite of telling
So simple advice, like, you know, maintaining the, it's when plaster distal with the MCP joint, allowing the six-pack exercises like MCP flexion, PAP flexion, and thumb movements makes a lot of difference in a long way to get back the function in these patients. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank yes, you. Asim.
Sir, may I ask one question to Anil, sir?
Sure.
Do you do that inside out technique of osteotomy sometimes?
Inside out technique means?
Being used to plan your osteotomy for a malunion?
Yes. Yeah, correct. We do plan, and we have done a few cases. But it's all
using arthroscope for that.
No. I'm not done.
Anil sir does wrist arthroscopy.
Correct. Yes. Yes. Any last sentence, Amit, before we close down? We are going to show a small video of TraumaCon subsequent to this.
What I feel is distal radius fresh if it comes. Results are of conservative as well as the operated cases are the same. Operated cases do well at the early phase. At 1 year down, both the results are quite the same.
Provided they are reduced well and maintained well.
Definitely. Yeah. And if you are operating, you have to study your X-ray first. And you should know your columns. And know where your radial styloid is. Know how good the split in the lunate fragment is. And then it's just a simple procedure. Know your incision and do it. Implants. And when to go dorsal, when to go molar. And as well as the brachioradialis release, as well as lateral plate, sometimes may be needed.
Yes. Yes, Anil, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for this opportunity. And last time when I met you in Pondicherry, the interaction was so good. I always remember how much time we spent together there and then what all we talked about. And again, the same thing I want to say in terms of the academic part of it, when you become the president, I want you to take up these kind of things in a big way so that we start training the postgraduates right from the time they're in postgraduate level to do all these things properly, right from putting a plaster properly to, you know, choosing the implants. So all are fascinated by volar locking plates, rim plates and everything, but the soft tissue part is not always taken care of. That is what is very important. To reach the bone, you know, those kind of training is not there. I think sometimes you feel really sad about those things. But otherwise, this was a great webinar. And I thank my panelists. I thank Neeraj and Ashok, both of them. And thank you for getting me on this.
Yes. All this, whatever the webinars we have been conducting in Ortho TV, their live recordings are available for anybody to see. So we have got a huge data thanks to Ortho TV for that, because whatever the webinars, we are almost there are 6 to 8 webinars per day. So it is classified and put as trauma, arthroscopy, joints like that. So you can go to that section and see all of them. There are so many things thanks to that pandemic, which made all of us Zoom savvy and also net savvy. And we all have time to do this webinar. That's also equally important. We should look at this pandemic in a positive way.
Which has
taught us so many new things for us.
Absolutely.
So I thank all the panelists, Dr. Asim Negi, Dr. Amit Ajgaonkar, Dr. Bharat Kadadi, for sending beautiful cases and sharing their experience. I know everyone of them on their own will be able to do this one man, one person talk, but they agreed to be on my panel as a panelist. I thank Professor Dr. Anil Bhatt. I know he's very, very busy because he operates before 12 o'clock in the morning. Then he has to go for the office work. He's the assistant dean and he has to be in the office almost up to 8 to 9 in the evening with such a big institution which they are looking after. One good thing to know that Dean Dr. Sharath Rao is also orthopedic surgeon and assistant dean Dr. Anil Bhatt is also orthopedic surgeon of such a great institution. Friends, for those who don't know, Manipal Institute, that's one of the premier institution, and I can say that Satya Nadella from Google is from Manipal Institute of Technology, where he has done his post-graduation. So that's the thing, they are producing the people like that. And once upon a time, not now, about 15 years back, even MBBS from Manipal was recognized in British, you could directly go and register your under in UK if you are MBBS from Manipal. No other institution in India had that privilege to have that degree registered. Thank you very much. Before we go, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani will be showing a small video of the TraumaCon. And I'll remind you that on Wednesday and Thursday, day after tomorrow, we have another great speaker, Dr. Deen Dayalan, talking about humerus non-union. And on Friday, we have a young orthopedic surgeon talking in Ortho Excellence Series. Dr. Jayant Sampath will be sharing some of the tips for supracondylar fractures of the humerus. Yes, over to Neeraj.
Yes, thank you very much. So this is the first time a virtual major conference is happening virtually. It's not called TraumaCon Mumbai. This time it's called TraumaCon World. And there are 3 to 4 main organizations involved, OTA, AOTS from Australia and Trauma Society of India. And Ortho TV will always be there. This is the website, traumacon.webconevents.com. The main advantage is that no registration, just like Ortho TV, directly click on the link and the conference starts. And to introduce, there is a small video which I would like to play. Can you see the video?
It has not come.
Okay. I'll just
we
play
it. We can only see that link.
Now,
the Australian Orthopaedic Trauma Society and the
I'll just play it again.
Gives me great pleasure to warmly invite you to attend TraumaCon, a global trauma conference over the weekend of August the 15th and August the 16th. We have over 12 countries with numerous faculty presenting a series of 44 case-based scenarios where we'll be able to ask questions, learn, hear the tips and tricks of the masters, and help improve our trauma outcomes. In these very difficult times of the COVID-19 pandemic, we are truly fortunate to be bringing together the Trauma Society of India, the Australian Orthopaedic Trauma Society, and the International Orthopaedic Trauma Association. As chairs, Sushrut Babulka and myself warmly invite you to attend, ask questions, participate, learn, and help make this event a great success. We look forward to seeing you there.
Thank you very much. You can stop the live stream.
Thank you very much, Shiva sir. Thank you, Anil sir. Great.